Hello, everyone. We are back for what I think is probably going to be the final session of our three-day inquiry into systemic racism in the City of Calgary as part of the City of Calgary's pivot to anti-racism. Obviously, there are people on the bridge and maybe teams that need to be muted. I'm joined in chambers by my co-chair, Dr. Smith, by my vice chair, Councillor Woolley, and by Councillor Gondek. Also joining us is Niall DeBreo, who is part of the five-person citizen panel of experts that started this inquiry off 3 days ago in the morning. We have basically the last groups on the list, and I'm going to build the last or the second last panel of this proceeding, which will be panel 25. And what I would like to do is ask, is there anyone on the line from any panel before 20? What panel were you part of, sir? Okay, I'm saying before 20. Anybody on the line or with us that was before 20? How about 25 to 21? Anyone who is listed on a panel 25 to 21 or 25 and below that did not get a chance to speak? Anyone from panel 26? That did not get a chance to speak. Anyone from panel 27? Panel 28? Panel 29?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. We have panel 28 here in the room, and I'm hearing someone from 29. Who are you, sir?
This is Kim Feng Zhao from panel 29.
Okay. Number one will be Dennis Ram, who has joined us in chambers. Number two, sir, on the line, what is your name?
Chun Feng
Zhao. Oh, 139.
Okay, Chun Feng Zhao, got you.
Thank you.
Can you please mute your phone, Chengfeng, and we will go to you after Dennis Ram speaks, and Dennis Ram will speak after I assemble the next panel of five. Is there anyone from panel 30 on the line? 31? 32. Okay, we're on to the last two panels. Is Tina Amini
on the line? Yes,
Tina, thank you for joining us. You're going to be the third speaker of this panel.
Okay.
Is Azra Tursik on the line? Is Jeff Halverson on the line? Is Pride Muma on the line? That means our last panelist is Chima Nikendram. Chima, are you on the line? Oh, wait. Is Chima on the line? I was just texting with him. I'm going to make Chima last. And Michael Broadfoot, are you on the line? Is Michael Broadfoot on the line? Okay, it's going to be Dennis Ram, Chengfeng Zhao, Tina Amini, and then Chima Nikendram. Chima's going to bat. What? Who's on the line?
Hi, sir.
Hi, sir. This is Carlos Richards. You can just put me last.
You know what? I'm going to put Chima Nakendram last. I'm going to put you second last, okay?
Sounds good. Thanks, sir.
Your name again? Carlos Richards?
Carlos Richards. Yes, thanks.
Okay.
I am here.
Who's I am is here? Who said that? Michael Broadfoot?
No, Chima is here.
Excellent. I didn't recognize your voice for some reason, Chima.
No problem, JC.
Okay. The last panel, 25, is six people. And everyone, please mute your line. Dennis Ram, here in chambers, is going to step up to the mic and start us off. Please join us, sir.
Mr. Chair, can we do a roll call first?
Oh, I apologize. Mr. Ram, I have to set yourself up, but we have to go through the roll call because I'm a bad chair.
Thank you.
Madam Clerk.
Councillor Chu.
Here.
Councillor Colley-Urquhart. Councillor Davidson.
Here.
Councillor Farkas. Councillor Maglioka. Councillor Woolley.
Present.
Mayor Nenshi.
Present.
Councillor Shahal.
Here.
Councillor DeMong. Councillor Farrell. Councillor Gondek.
Yes.
Councillor Jones. Councillor Keating?
Here.
Councillor Maglioka? And Councillor Kara?
Present in chambers. All right.
Excuse me, I'm sorry, this is Councillor Sutherland. You missed me.
My apologies. Noted, you're here. Thank you.
Councillor DeMong is here as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Council. We're finishing strong. I appreciate everyone's endurance through this intense 3 days. Mr. Ram, the floor is yours.
Hello, Council. My name is Dennis Ram, and I'm currently a law student. I was raised in Calgary with my elementary school, junior high school, and post-secondary located right here in this city. I'm here today to share a few stories about racism faced by Calgarians every day and what Council can do to remedy these issues. These stories I'm sharing are from my friends, my family, and myself. Minorities in Calgary are fearful to speak about racism because they know there's always a backlash. Here are just some of their stories. One day, me and a few friends were kicking a soccer ball around at a soccer field. Out of nowhere, the police helicopter spotlit us, blinding us with a bright light. As we turned around, six police vehicles stormed into the nearby parking lot. Scared and confused, we all started walking to the police, not sure why we were being treated this way. The officer asked what we were doing, and we showed him the soccer ball. The officer said originally he was there because of suspicious activity, and then later said because we weren't allowed in city fields after 9 p.m. I had never heard of this bylaw before, so I had asked the officer what time it was. The officer just replied, "It's almost 9 p.m. So what we were doing was nothing wrong, yet more than 10 officers and the helicopter decided to target us. The police then told us we had to leave the soccer field. I told my friends just to come to my house. They were visibly shaken. The entire drive back to my house, the police helicopter followed us, close enough that we could hear it the entire way back. We felt like criminals, even though we did nothing wrong. Next experience. One day, before I dropped a friend home, he asked if I could stop by a 7-Eleven so he could buy some 5-cent candy. As I parked and he got out, a police van aggressively drove up to us. An officer walked up to me and said, "Get the F out right now," and the other officer grabbed my friend's arm and threw him against the car. I asked what we were doing wrong, and he said, "Get out of your car." Once I got out, he slammed my head to my car, kicked my legs apart, groped my penis and testicles as part of his pat-down, and then handcuffed me. He forced me and my friend to sit handcuffed on a busy road where anyone we know could have seen us while they searched the inside of my car. They threw everything in my glove box to the back seat, everything in my trunk to the front seat. They destroyed my car and made us watch while we feared a family member would see us being this way. When I told them they didn't have reasonable grounds to search my car, the officer laughed and asked me what I wanted to be one day. I told him I want to be a lawyer. He pointed at me and said, "You will never be a lawyer." That man's face and hate will forever be ingrained in my memory. When I asked him, after he found nothing and told us to leave, I asked him where his badge number was because I could see the Velcro spot, but no number or name. He looked me dead in the face and said, "Do you want to sleep in a holding cell tonight?" I was only 17. I didn't have my voice, so I went home scared. To this day, I still think at night about this officer and how many other people this officer's harassed, how many other people this officer's illegally searched. Next experience. On Canada Day, me and a white friend went downtown to celebrate. We were both dressed in full Canada Day gear, and we bought a Canadian flag attached to a hockey stick, because what's more Canadian than that, right? The entire time we were downtown, people were coming up to us, complimenting us, taking photos with us because of how Canadian we looked. My white friend had to go to the washroom at around noon, so I held on to his hockey stick for a few minutes. In those short few minutes, a police officer walked up to me and told me if I didn't put that hockey stick away, he would. I didn't want to cause any trouble, and I told him we would as soon as my friend came out of the washroom. Once I told my friend what happened, he recognized it might be racism and said, "Let the white guy hold on to this, and if they ask us again, we'll put it away." We were downtown until 2 in the morning without any issues. That day, I realized I cannot celebrate Canada Day like a true Canadian because of my skin color. If I was white, like my friend was, there would have been no issues. But because I have dark skin, I am less Canadian and not allowed to celebrate the way everyone else can. This is what the police has done to me. Next experience. I would like to quickly mention the Twitter account of Constable Mark Smith of the Calgary Police. Just recently, actually yesterday, he posted a picture of a bloody police car backseat. Since the person that had been thrown in the backseat of the police car was lacking mental capacity and self-harmed to the point of bleeding all over the seat, I asked the officer on Twitter if he had a duty to ensure those lacking mental capacity in his custody didn't self-harm. Pretty simple question. Instead, the officer said he's going to mute me and didn't engage further. This is an officer that's branded as one of the good cops on Twitter. So I was expecting to hear some sort of reply, not just simply ignoring me. If the police officer lets someone lacking mental capacity self-harm, this officer has a duty of care to make sure that does not happen. Now, after seeing this post, there are many Calgarians that do not want Constable Mark Smith responding to wellness calls or any call with someone lacking mental capacity, because he clearly will let them self-harm, post about it on Twitter, and then not ask about any of the repercussions. This is an officer that does not understand their legal obligations to the public, and all officers need to understand if someone is lacking mental capacity and is in their custody, they cannot simply allow that person to self-harm to the point of bleeding all over the inside of the squad car. And finally, I grew up going to public schools. It's an everyday insult knowing that if I wanted a better, publicly funded education, all I had to do was convert religions to Catholicism. Catholic schools brag about their better student outcomes. It's not a mystery, but they continue to segregate these benefits to predominantly white students. I do not believe in segregation. Forcing visible minorities, which are predominantly not Catholic, to simply start praying to a white God if they want a better education is one of the last remaining forms of colonization we're seeing here today in Calgary. Why is it that there's a huge section of Calgarians that have never been in a classroom with a Muslim, with a Hindu, with a Buddhist? This system, it breeds intolerance. Further, how can we say separate but equal is actually working when we see from the outcomes it's clearly not? In summary, Council, thank you for your time. There's a lot of work to be done. Specifically, I have 3 calls to action. The first, that we open up more emergency services branches with funding shifted from the police budget. The last time funds shifted from the police, it was to create the EMS. Why does 911 only connect us to three branches? Fire, EMS, police. There's room for innovation here, and I think this is the council that could get that innovation done. There's room here where we could add numerous more non-violent branches that are better funded, better equipped, and better trained to handle all of these issues. Second, we must educate in our own Calgary schools about our own racism here in Calgary, including the multiple race riots that have happened here in our hometown. I used to joke that I live in the Northeast because I'm brown. And now I feel uncomfortable making that, knowing that there were race riots that literally moved colored folk into the Northeast because too many were moving into the Southwest. We act smug, looking at the United States, thinking we're better than them, and ignore our own racism. And finally, I call upon ending segregation of publicly funded schools. This is public money supporting segregation. Newfoundland passed a referendum that was as follows. Do you support a single school system where all children, regardless of religious affiliation, attend the same school where opportunities for religious education and observances are provided? If our city of Calgary, collaborates with Edmonton and other large Alberta municipalities, we can stop segregation. We can do it. This system we claim is separate but equal, clearly, disproportionately advantages white Calgarians. Thank you all for your time this evening, and I really hope some change will get done. I will also be emailing this speech to all members of council with hopes that we can engage further in conversations. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your time, for going the distance with us, Mr. Ram, and great presentation. You know, some really chilling examples of racism, part of the system, as Dr. Smith says, this is part of the master class we're getting in systemic racism, and three extremely compelling calls to action. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor.
Cheng Feng Zhao.
Hello.
Hello, I hear you loud and clear.
Hello, my name is Chen Feng Zhao, and I have been a Calgarian since 2009. Today, I'm going to share an experience which I had a very hard time to get over with. It was about 3 years ago, about 1 a.m. past midnight. I was walking east on 5th Avenue Southwest towards the intersection of 6th Street Southwest. 1.5 block away, a lady in high heels was running west, also towards the same intersection. Behind her, a bigger man was chasing her. The lady was breathing heavily, apparently out of energy. I believe she saw me and made extra effort to run in towards the intersection where I was. I paused. My brain went through the options I could have. I made my turn and kept walking towards the C-Train station. The lady crossed 6th Street and got to my previous parking spot, but only to see me crossing 6th Avenue. She ran south for another half block and eventually got pinned onto a building wall by the bigger man. One block away, I saw the bigger man beating the lady, and I heard she screaming. Seconds later, I got to the C-Train station and started calling 911. I was asked a normal question like who I am, was I safe, where I was. I then reported the incident. Then I got the question that has shocked me until now. What is the victim's race? That was from the 911 responder. I repeat. What is the victim's race? I asked, what do you mean? The responder said, is she white or blah, blah? Stunned, I said, why does that matter? But for that moment, I was made to believe that white life matters more. So I said, the victim is a Caucasian. And I added, the person who's chasing her is not. although I was not 100% sure. I was then told that because my cell phone is not registered, they were not giving me a follow-up on whether they sent out police officers for her. So today I want to ask my respectable council members, does the race of the victim matter? Should that be a factor affecting how an emergency is dealt with? Do our police service care more about certain race? If you have the same answer as me, I request to have an inquiry or procedure check of 911 responding. If there is any clause about victim's race, it should be removed. I wish all Calgarians will get the same service they need and are entitled to without discrimination. And here may I also request to have a whatever follow-up on this inquiry I just made. By the way, I appreciate the statement from CPS, but I hope there will be action followed. Thank you, councillors, for your hard working, and let me speak. Thank you.
Thank you for that presentation. Another compelling testimony. Really appreciate your sharing with us, and I think the answer, of course, to your questions is that no, it should not matter what the race of the person who is in need of assistance is with regard to the quality of assistance they receive from our emergency services. Thank you, Chung Feng. Can you please mute and make some space for Tina Amini? Tina?
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, okay, so I was not planning on speaking for this hearing, but after hearing—
Can you speak up a little bit more so we can hear you better, please?
Yeah.
Perfect, thank you.
Can you hear me better now?
Way better. The floor is yours.
Okay. So I was not planning on speaking for this hearing, but after hearing some stories, such as Mr. Messiah's yesterday morning, I felt compelled to share my story about my experiences with the Calgary Police. In 2010, I was 20, and my license was suspended. So I had a friend drive me somewhere in my car. We had gotten pulled over because the police officer noticed that my license plate was registered to my name, and my name was suspended for driving for 30 days. The officer pulled us over and asked for our license and registration. My friend that was driving the car did not have a license, so the police had every right to tow my car away. I'm an Iranian Canadian, born in Calgary, and my friends in the car are black immigrants from Africa. We spoke to the officers and understood that the car would be towed at the impound lot. We then had a friend pick us up and drove away. Upon driving away, I had noticed that the police officer kept my license and my registration. This was not my first time having an officer keep my documents, such as registration or proof of insurance and license. So I immediately turned around and went back to the scene because I knew it would be nearly impossible to find the officer with my documents, as they're usually not in office and on patrol or whatever. So if you've ever had your car impounded, you know you need your driver's license, registration, and proof of insurance to get your car out. If you don't have these documents, you have to pay a fee every night that your car is in there until you get your documents. So when I came back to the scene, about just 1 minute after leaving, I told the officer to give me back my registration and license. The officer immediately arrested me and told me to stop making a scene. Mind you, there was not many homes nearby or businesses, as we were near a football field. Either ways, he arrested me. I asked why I was being arrested, and he told me to stop resisting. Then, while arrested, the sergeant walked me to his car. I had to walk across the field as his car was parked on the other side of the field. I tripped and fell while handcuffed and being guided by the officer to his car. I was in front of the officer, and he was behind me holding the handcuffs, guiding me towards the car. When I tripped and fell, I was falling, and the officer pushed me down harder to the ground. He put his knee in my back and his elbow on my neck, and I was thrown down. I got whiplash, and I had bruises on my wrists. They then took me to District 5 Station, where I was held for 6 hours, and they eventually charged me with 6 criminal charges. I was charged with interrupting an investigation, resisting arrest, causing a disturbance, obstruction of justice, and the worst, most messed up charge was the attempt to disarm an officer. The officer somehow thought that as I was falling, I was attempting to take his firearm, which makes no sense. What could I possibly do with a firearm while I'm handcuffed? I was 20 at the time and did not have money for a lawyer. So I took a criminal discharge guilty plea to assaulting an officer. To this day, I have this in my criminal record for a simple traffic stop. There was no need for the officers to be so cruel and to attempt to destroy the future of a 20-year-old with so many criminal offenses, especially when they were in the wrong for keeping my documents. If they could have just done their job properly and gave me my documents, I would have not gone through that trauma. I would maybe be less scared of the police in Calgary. Now, I would never call the police if anything is to happen to me, because as far as I'm concerned, they can do more harm than help. I do not think they're ever able to help me in any situation, especially when they pull up my name and see a criminal offense like assaulting an officer on my record. When I was 20, I had no criminal record. My only offense was having black friends and being in the Northeast. I can just imagine how they would treat me today. So that's my story. And in general, I agree with many of the other people that spoke today and this whole week about defunding the police. I think that we also think that we need to have racist and abusive police fired immediately. We also need to have a different organization or part of the city investigate police rather than police policing each other, because I did try to file a complaint and became very discouraged once I found out that Edmonton police would be investigating my complaint. So I never went further with it. And thank you for your time. I'm done.
Thank you for sharing, Tina. That is very disheartening to hear, but it is amazing testimony and very important for us to hear it. I'm sorry you dealt with that. Thank you for sharing. Please mute your phone. And Michael Broadfoot, are you on the line? Not hearing Michael Broadfoot. Carlos Richards, are you on the line?
Yes, I am.
The floor is yours.
All right. Can you hear me clearly?
Very clearly.
Oh, good. Okay. So I bet you guys didn't think you were going to be talking about racism for this long, eh? See, you know, I think what we've witnessed from the testimony from a lot of the people that have come before me over the last few days, and you know, you've witnessed the pain and trauma of a community that's been suffering for decades, ignored suffering for decades. You know, I'm watching over here in Toronto. I moved from Barbados to Calgary in the year 2000, lived in Calgary up until last year. And would I say that I can testify that many of the issues that were raised by other panelists are things that have been experienced by people that I know, by myself in some fashion. And, you know, this is, you know, it's good that people were given a forum in which to express themselves. We heard testimony as it relates to the interaction, people's interactions with police. We heard of the challenges where racist practices in the education system had people attend an ESL related courses that essentially increased their workload and could potentially have disenfranchised them in progressing through their studies. We heard about the changing of the name of an event because the word black was in it. You know, because of the negative connotations that could result of that word and the challenges of getting sponsorship from the Calgary community as it related to an event that would award black excellence in the city. We heard that lady with multiple stories, where including her son being pushed down an elevator, you know, sitting down and listening to that, I assume that everybody felt the same level of pain that I did listening to her testimony. And then finally today, something that, you know, I don't think any of us in the community would have known about, and the firefighter suicide. This is now a situation that we can't even fix. And most of the other testimony, you're listening to people that are alive to share their experience. Firefighter suicide problems already, it's too late, right? And, you know, hearing that individuals that might have helped, you know, be catalysts for that event, being rewarded for their service to the community when there was the service that actually occurred. So, you know, all in that, you know, to say that I'm happy that this forum and this session was created, but I am a little pessimistic as it relates to what's going to happen. I do not believe that you can legislate racism or anti-racism. The issue as it relates to racism is something that's deep within the hearts and minds of people. It is has been passed on from generation to generation. It is arguably in some people's DNA, as you would have seen with that guy that probably is surrounded by minorities but thought that he could come today and lay negative testimony to what we're seeing, you know, people's pain and suffering, and essentially relate, you know, our protests and whatnot to risks as it relates to a lesser disease of COVID-19. Racism is a greater disease than COVID-19, and racism is something that we need to address immediately with the same level of enthusiasm as we did the pandemic. Now, some suggestions, because obviously I only have so much time. What you've heard from many people that came before is access to opportunity. What does that look like? It's not just in providing educational grants. It is, as many mentioned, holding businesses accountable for how they staff themselves. I know, council, you'll have little control over that. So as you discuss that, that's more something that you can include in your political platforms, where you're showing that social accountability and responsibility to society by being open, even though it might not be in your best interest as it relates to securing racist votes. It might not be in your best interest to bring these things up, but I challenge you to be the ones that do it. Education. Education is key. I thought the comment from the young lawyer, student law, earlier as it related to dismantling the segregation of education system, something that, to me, you know, that's a divide that exists. We know that there's issues in the world as it relates to religion. Why do we encourage such a thing to occur in our society when Canada's supposed to be an example for the world to follow? As it relates to teaching, I'll focus on Black history, but obviously there are other races that exist in our society. But, you know, Black history isn't slavery and civil rights. It's not American history. It isn't just discussions about cowboys that might have existed in Alberta years ago. Education on Black history would be for you to look at your population, look at the diasporas, Black diasporas that they come from across the world, and see how you could incorporate those histories and the histories of in places like the Caribbean, for example, which has probably the richest history as it relates to Western Hemisphere struggle and racist struggle. Maybe look to some of those examples for your education system, so that a sense of pride, where you're talking about places that actually have Black leaders, are examples that you're teaching to these children, so that it's not just a discussion about, you know, the civil rights it's something that where we're really trying to strive towards a discussion about equal rights and true equality for all. We also need to talk about the negatives in our education. Some of the racist practices that exist amongst all races. It's not just white oppression to Black. It's not just white oppression to Indigenous people. It's not just white oppression to Asian and other minorities. It is the interaction between all races that we need to deal with if we're actually trying to combat anti-racism. There is now, because the structure was developed by those that currently benefit as it relates to white supremacy, there is some level of responsibility in its dismantlement by individuals that look like yourself, Mr. Chairman. But as I see, you're already making those necessary steps with this forum. We need more authentic community involvement by city council. Stop with the minority bucks, you know, the throwing of monies to different associations that can name themselves well. True involvement where the money that's invested into these organizations that will help promote the various ethnicities that exist in the city of Calgary is spent in a manner that's actually going to have results, not a couple little dinners and festivals here and there, but true community integration. Also, when you guys attend, don't just give a speech and leave. Mark your day, and not just one of you show up. All of you guys are there to secure our votes. Everyone's spread out across the city. It doesn't matter if they're in your ward or not. If there's an event that's not part of your culture and you're saying that you're battling anti-racism, you're at that event. You're at that event for the full day, and you're talking to everybody that's at that event. One thing I noticed was the how Mr. Dabiro handled himself. I thought that he did an amazing job of steering the discussion, kind of holding council in check for where we might have, initially, had the best intentions, but, helped us not go down the road to help. And I thought he did an amazing job. And I would challenge the members here that know that you have lobbyists that are friends that are lobbyists, or you, and, if you want to battle systemic racism, you need various races in the system. And maybe there's an individual there that you might want to put on a platform, because it seems as though he allows a lot of people in the community to feel comfortable to be themselves, to be their true authentic selves, so you guys really understand what is going on in your community and can actually promote true and positive change. And finally, these things cannot end. What you did here is great, and it can continue. The city has invested a significant amount of taxpayer dollars in building a beautiful library. I would like to suggest that a monthly racism panel is organized in which all members of the public that are willing to have an open and honest discussion about race are given that opportunity. There's there would be a chairman, obviously police presence to protect the individuals from any hate groups that might arise, but also, allow for that open dialogue so that it's been my experience, my personal experience, that the only way to combat these issues is through social interaction. I remember my days at Mount Royal College before it was a university, and one of the ways that we really tackled some of the ignorance that existed amongst our now friends of all various races was by talking about it, checking their ignorance, holding them accountable for the silly perceptions they had of what it meant to be Black. I encourage everybody to engage in that dialogue. It doesn't need to be hostile. It just needs to be honest. If there are any questions for me, I would invite them right now, but I think
Carlos, that was a really great testimony, like a really thoughtful review of some of the highlights of other speakers. I think the fact that you spoke the pain and that all of us felt reliving some of the traumas that were related to us, and just an incredible set of recommendations. Thank you so much for those. I'm going to ask you to mute, but stay on the line, because we do have requests to speak from some of the from some of the counselors, and their questions might involve what you said. So please stay with us. I'm going to ask again. What's up? Well, who's on the line? Okay, good. We've been pretty good with the mute button, everybody. Is Michael Broadfoot on the line? Okay, I'm going to give it to the last speaker of these proceedings, Chima Nikendram. Chima. Are you there, sir? Chima, I think you're muted. Yeah, we can hear you now.
Oh, you hear me? Okay, great.
Hear you loud and clear. The floor is yours.
Thank you. I just want to thank Council for taking the time to have this really important conversation. You know, I know there's been some criticism of this process, but I think it's great that Council has decided to provide a forum for Calgarians to simply tell their stories. And I've had an opportunity over the last couple of days to listen in and hear some of these stories. You know, a little bit about myself. You know, my parents made a choice a long, long time ago to build their careers and raise their family here in Calgary, which is the city of my birth. You know, and I went to great public schools here, went on to earn a business degree and a law degree. And I eventually became a partner in one of Canada's largest law firms. And for many years, I served as chief of staff to Mayor Nenshi and had the opportunity to work with many of you. So by all accounts, I've done okay. But I want this council to know that it doesn't matter how successful you are or how hard you've worked or how much community service you do. If you are black or brown, we live in a community where the police will stop you on the street for simply walking down the street, for simply walking while you're black and brown. And you've heard those stories over the past few days. And it's this issue of carding that you as a member of our municipal government really need to stop. Every study that has been done on this issue shows that it's visible minorities that get stopped over and over again for just simply for walking while being black or brown. And it doesn't matter if you're a student like the young man who spoke earlier this evening, or you're a lawyer like myself, or you're even the chief of staff to the mayor, you get stopped randomly. And when the police are faced with criticism of this practice, rather than fundamentally address their practices, they simply change the name and turn it from carding to street checks. And I wanted to say, no matter what you call it, this practice is a clear example of systemic racism, and it's fundamentally wrong. Now, I'm well aware that council does not direct the police, but even though you don't direct the police, you have enormous influence, and you have a duty to ensure that this practice comes to an end. Council funds the police, council appoints a police commission. And at the end of the day, citizens can only turn to our elected officials to ensure that their fundamental rights are respected. So it should be in our community, in our city, that every citizen, regardless of their race, their gender, their sexual orientation, is respected by law enforcement. And I encourage you to take what you've heard today, take it seriously, as I know you will, and work hard to end this fundamentally racist practice that is pervasive in Canadian police forces. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much, Chima. I have a request to speak from Councillor Ward Sutherland. Ward, are you there?
Yes, thank you. Is Mr. Ram still on?
Mr. Ram is still in chambers, and he's walking down to the mic. He's at the mic, Ward. Ask away.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. Mr. Ram, I'm really sorry for the different circumstances that happened in your stories and the different amounts to your friends and the embarrassment. I couldn't imagine that in many different ways. My question is, you were talking about school systems, which of course is provincial jurisdiction, not municipal, but within the school system, I'm curious what you said, because within the school system itself, it's above, I think the province spends about $7 billion on it. The funding that they have is actually for charter schools, private schools, public schools, and the Catholic schools. So they fund There's different funding for all schools and Francophone also. So are you just saying that when you brought up Catholic, that all those other schools should exist and only Catholic should not exist?
No, actually, just to specifically address that, that might just be a bit of a misconception. I never once said that public schools and private schools should all be abolished. You know, if Catholics want to continue to have their own system that's a private system that is not publicly funded, by all means, they can continue to have that. The point here is that our publicly funded system is a two-tiered, segregated, publicly funded system. If you want to have segregation in private schools, that is a completely different conversation. But here today, we're talking about a publicly funded school that I don't have access to because I pray to the wrong God.
Okay. So the fact that on a, you do realize that on, when a tax bill comes, the taxpayer for the property tax actually chooses to direct their tax education money to the Catholic system.
I'm just going to loop back to my point that separate but equal has never worked. And we can see from the outcomes here, it's clearly not working. And we can also see from the outcomes here that it's predominantly white Calgarians that are benefiting from this segregated system. I think that just explains it well enough. And, you know, if we're going to talk semantics about budget, that's a great conversation we should have. But you know what? If you're okay with a segregated, publicly funded system, just own it and say you're okay with segregation.
So as being educated in the Catholic system, we've been taught to accept everybody. So I'm not quite sure. That's why I'm asking. The practices of the religion doesn't teach any racism or discrimination. So that's why I was wondering what the point you were coming from, because there's chartered schools that are also paid by public funding, just not Catholic. All these other schools get public money. The charter schools, whether it's Jewish or Muslim, et cetera, they all get public funding of part of the charter schools.
Yeah, Councillor, I'm sorry. I think you're mixing up the difference between a private school and a publicly funded school. Just because publicly funded schools receive more tax money to fund their schools than the private school system does. And then furthermore, if we're simply saying that, you know what, they are inclusive, they are accepting, I would like you to turn back to the Newfoundland referendum. Because if they are an accepting and open system, desegregation should be easy then, as long as we allow the opportunities for them to take part in their religious activities, their religious observances. I don't see why this segregated system needs to happen. And I'm all for, you know, everyone being friendly and accepting. That's just going to make this whole process that much easier when we desegregate.
Okay, thank you for your view.
Thank you.
That's all my questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Sutherland. Is there anyone else on the line who has not had a chance to speak?
Well, while Mr. Ram is here, I just want to address on that point.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah.
I apologize.
I did attend the separate school system. I was born and raised Catholic to many extents, but I wrote a paper in law school about something that relates to this, and it has to do with the statutory holidays and how they're observed. And it's funny, it was always interesting to me that despite, call me crazy, perhaps I might be like that guy Lionel that spoke yesterday who had cerebral palsy, but had concerns for people other than maybe his own, you know, his own branch of concerns. But the public school system still follows the same seemingly Christian-based holiday patterns that the separate school system did. And we all know that the observances of all the people that are categorized into a public school are broad. And so it struck me that there was no flexibility with it. So I think that speaks to kind of that, the pressure that's put on people that partake in that different sphere under the public funding. But if you could comment on that, please.
I mean, it would be great if Diwali was a public holiday, but I think that's something that's maybe a discussion for another day. Like specifically, I'm not sure exactly what the question is you're asking there, Mr. DeBrio.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is you're speaking about this access to public funds, but I can discuss it with you later. I mean, there's a lot of people here to talk, but if you, perhaps it's too long-winded. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions for Mr. Ram or any of the other speakers from the last panel? Mayor Nanshi, do Do you want to give Mr. Nikendram a little bit of heck?
As a matter of fact, I do.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ram, and thank you for your testimony. You know, I'm a Northeast Calgary boy born and bred, and I heard a lot of me, a lot older, in a lot of what you had to say, and thank you for being here for that. I am actually going to ask Mr. Nikendram a question, if I may, and I haven't warned him I'm going to do it, but he's used to me putting him on the spot.
Are you still on the line, Chima?
Oh, yes.
I've been surprised. There's not a lot. Surprisingly, there's not a lot that surprised me in the last few days, and I'll say some more about that as we move forward. But one of the things that has surprised me is we haven't heard a lot about the issue that you raised about carding, not as much as I thought we would. And I'm wondering if you could give us a little more personal experiences or experiences of people you know about how they're experiencing that in Calgary. Because we often hear, oh, street checks and carding are an issue in other places. And I've heard that from the police. I would like to know what it's like on the ground here. And as you say, you're someone with privilege and authority and education. And I'm interested in how you and people you know are experiencing this.
Sure. I mean, so just from personal basis, let me just talk about being stopped by the police. I'm pretty sure every time I drive by a police car, I'm sure my plates get run. No matter what I'm doing. And if there's anything wrong with your car or something like that, you get pulled over. So every time you know, and that's going on for years. But I know a number of black friends who live and work in the Beltline. Work downtown. They're professionals, live in the Beltline, get stopped walking to work, walking from work, 5-6 times a year. And these stories are very, very common right here in Calgary. And they haven't done anything. And I think this is the thing that's really fundamentally wrong, is that the police get to use this process of, well, we're just checking. You're doing something suspicious. And what's suspicious about walking down the street? Or we're looking for someone who looks like you. Now, Calgary's only 33% visible minority, which is the third highest in the country. But still, when you look at the studies that are done across Canada, it's overwhelmingly disproportionately that visible minorities get stopped. And the question I keep asking is, the police keep defending this practice. And my question is, why? You know, people forget that the top law in this country is the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And that law has placed fundamental restrictions on how the police do their job. And that was done to ensure that people are treated fairly. There isn't an abuse of power, an abuse of authority. This issue of carding has been going on across this country for years, and nobody does anything about it. But I don't understand why. Because there's something really, you know, it's like when you go into a store. If you talk to black or brown people, do you get followed more in the store? So often that happens. You know, it's a very common experience. Well, I can't do anything about the store security guard, but I do pay for the police through my taxes. And so I expect that I'm not going to get arbitrarily stopped for simply going to work or going home or going to a restaurant or just going for a walk with my dog. That's the fundamental issue.
Thank you. That's all I had.
I don't know if this is relevant, but over 30 years ago...
is this Carlos?
It was... No, this is Craig.
I was
part of the earlier panel.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I'm still with you. I'm still listening. I was carded for having long hair and a leather jacket. So I don't necessarily, I know it is racial, or it's profiling, but it's not necessarily all racial as well. So police practices definitely have changed over 30 years. So like I said, you have to take that with a grain of salt. And
thank you, Craig. I think the point that Mr. Nikendram was trying to make is that it's a statistically proven fact that people of color, black and indigenous people, are carded at a statistically way higher rate than anyone else, even people with long hair, and even white people with long hair and leather jackets. I'm going to ask if there's anyone else who has any questions for this. Oh, Councillor Chahal has a question.
Thank you to all the presenters on this panel. Question for Mr. Nikendram on talking about racial, on carding or profiling. Do you believe, I guess, from some of the folks you talk to, being carded and put into a database system has affected them moving forward in life? Maybe been profiled and targeted again, or has impacted their ability to find other opportunities through requirements of police checks that may occur and then being in that database system?
I don't know. I think a lot of people don't actually realize that there's a database that the police keep on that. I think what's more fundamental is that people feel that they're not as much as a citizen as their neighbor, right? And that there's a fundamental amount of unfairness to it. And it's just like all racism. It's like you're lesser than, right? You're lesser than your white friend who's walking down the same street wearing the same baseball hat that you are, going with the same Flames jersey. I think there's a lot of issue questions about how they keep that data, what they do with it. I don't think it's very well known to people or why they're doing that. So I think it's more the act of being stopped and being persistently stopped for no apparent reason. It just reinforces that you're not an equal member of the community.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I think that's an important question that we need to ask and address, if that data is collected and stored in a database and how it is intended or used after initially collected. Thank you for your answer.
I just have one question.
Sure.
It's kind of directed at two. I believe Mr. Richards identified himself as a black man and having had interactions with police. And Mr. Ram, I believe is your name. I'm just curious because from the situations I recall both of you describing, I'm curious if you believe that it was relevant or not, if the police were even partaking in a carding situation with you, or if it comes down to just the fact of how you're treated, having not broken the law in the first place. I think personally, it seems to me that carding can sometimes be an inlet into an interaction, but as we've heard from Mr. Ram, which maybe you can comment on, these interactions don't have to be based on give me your ID, I want to know your name. It can simply be the coercive force of the police. But I'll ask that to Mr. Richards first, and then perhaps Mr. Ram can comment after.
Are you still on the line, Mr. Richards?
Yes, I am. I think Mr. Albert makes a great point there. I think everyone can tell their side of the story, and it's us versus the police discussion. I think if we're respecting the concerns brought up by people on the call, on the line, and in city council, I think if we're respecting that, I think it's irrelevant whether or not people are telling you that it's impacting them. I think we should just listen. I'm going to speak on behalf of the Asian community. In the late 2000s, there was gang-related violence that was being attributed to the Asian community in Calgary, and I watched many of my friends get carded by police just simply for being maybe having tattoos and being looking like the individuals that they believe. I actually don't understand the logic behind it, but if you think about what that does to their, you know, their how they will then feel about themselves or even how other people perceive them, not everybody that sees that interaction gets the explanation of, oh, the cops made a mistake. They're just like, oh, maybe that person's involved in something illegal. So I think what we really need to do here is listen to people, accept what they're telling us, and I think we should instruct police stop doing it. That's your job as city council.
Thank you, Mr. Richards. We're going to ask Mr. Ram to also respond.
Yeah, just with regard to carding and the random police stops, I think sometimes they do feed off of each other. I think police knowing they have an easily accessible right to card anyone of color whenever they like makes it easier for them to justify randomly pulling someone over, randomly searching someone, because they've done it before. But unfortunately, just due to the time limit, I didn't get a chance to speak about very specific carding incidences that have happened here in Calgary, specifically the gang suppression unit. Anytime me and my colored friends see the gang suppression unit walk in, we cringe. Because what happens 9 times out of 9, literally, is they will scan the room, they'll see the darkest table of people, they'll walk over to that table, they treat us like criminals, they ask us for all of our IDs, they demand we say where we're gonna go, and then if one person is like later harassed, we're all gonna get a phone call by the police. I think that's a completely separate issue than what we're seeing, you know, with the police officers randomly pulling people over. I think the carding in Calgary is so specific and targeted that, you know, it's crazy that this is something we're still debating about. I think, you know, all you have to do is just go on social media to see how many people have posted videos of this exact unit specifically targeting colored folks on Stephen Ave. I have friends that have stopped going to bars and establishments specifically because they keep getting carded there. And even myself, I'm a law student, it's going to be so embarrassing the very first time I get carded by gang suppression and I'm with my classmates. And I dread that moment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any other questions for this panel? Okay. I'm now going to ask, I can see that there's no one in chambers who hasn't had an opportunity to present. I'm going to ask if there's anyone on the line who has not yet had an opportunity to present. Okay, I'm going to ask everyone who's on the line to hang up and switch over to the feed, to the web feed, the web broadcast. And we're going to officially close public submissions after 3 days. And we're going to do so with a tremendous amount of solemnity and gratitude that people were so willing to share with us everything we needed to hear. And I think some of us needed to hear it more than others of us. But I don't think there's anyone here who hasn't been moved and altered by the last 3 days. So I'm going to close public submissions and we're going to have a conversation about what comes next. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to sketch out for everybody how this works. And keep in mind, and I'm very well aware of the fact that this whole process has been has been the object of legitimate criticisms. What we tried to do when we established this process was strike a balance between doing something officially within the walls of government and yet altering it enough so that A, it was welcoming, and B, it symbolizes our willingness to change procedure, because that's what this is all about. It's about changing what we do to fundamentally pivot from talking about how racism is bad to becoming actively anti-racist and changing things. So, and we're not going to go into how we struck that balance. I think we've talked about the panel, we've talked about the co-chairs, But the fact is, this is still an official meeting, a special meeting of Community and Protective Services. And the way committees work in the City of Calgary is that we discuss things as a committee, we hear from the public and discuss things with the public, and then we make recommendations to council. And when council approves these things at the next council meeting, and the next council meeting, I believe, is July 20th, Monday, July 20th, then it becomes the law of the land and we head into action mode. Now, on Tuesday morning, before we heard from our expert panel, after our Siksika elders started things in a good way with a smudge ceremony, and after Mayor Nenshi set the context for the proceedings, we received a report from administration that talked about what was our history to date in trying to tackle racism, and then what are the recommendations before us. Those recommendations were deliberately, I don't want to say vague, but they were not super concrete, because it would have been, I think, a betrayal of the process we've just gone through to pre-decide how we were going to react. And so we have recommendations that are before us that Councillor Chahal moved. And I think that after the end of 3 days, we're all sort of physically and emotionally exhausted and moved. And we're not in a position to do committee work of sort of evolving those recommendations and making them more concrete and expanding them to include the things that we heard. Those recommendations, by the way, can we maybe put them up on the screen? So it says that the Standing Policy Committee on Community and Protective Services recommend that, one, we approve the Anti-Racism Action Committee Terms of Reference. I personally feel at the end of this process that we need to alter some of those terms of reference to respond to the things we heard. Direct that a What We Heard report from the public consultation be provided to support the development of the anti-racism strategy. That absolutely has to happen, but maybe we have to be clear about how that report is structured, because we can't have a business as usual report. Number three, direct the Anti-Racism Action Committee to provide a progress update to the Standing Policy Committee and Protective Services no later than Q3 2021 and approve the Anti-Racism Capacity Building Fund Terms of Reference. I think all of these can be firmed up and tweaked a little to provide clearer direction, but I don't think we're in a position to do that work now. So what I'm going to recommend we do as a committee is that we pass these, and in the time between now and the 20th, we do the necessary adjustments. And when we introduce them on the floor of council on the 20th, we say, this is how we've evolved these recommendations to be a bit clearer. Here's a recommendation or two that we've added in response to the experience of this, of these proceedings, and we pass it into law at that point. But I think what we need to do now is we need to share some of the reflections that we've heard and commit as a council, as individual council members, to the pivot that we need to make from listening to action. So I know that Councillor Woolley would like to start off. I know that Councillor Chahal is going to close at the end. I know that myself, Mr. DeBreo, my co-chair, Dr. Smith, has things to say. I imagine Councillor Gondek has things to say. I know that Mayor Nenshi has things to say. And the question is, are any of the councillors who are watching from home interested in sharing some reactions and stating some commitments with regard to what we've heard over the last 3 days? I will receive from you guys at home, council members at home, a request to speak, and I will turn the floor over to Councillor Woolley. Are you ready, sir?
I am not often nervous to turn on my mic, but I am quite nervous now, and words matter immensely, and we've learned that particularly over the last 3 days, and it was brought up at the conversion therapy conversation that words are like weapons, and so I'm going to try and be very thoughtful. I wrote 25 pages of handwritten notes, and I spent a couple hours today trying to form them into a little bit of something that I could reflect on. And I'm going to mention a lot of names, and I'm going to preempt that. Councillor Carra had the opportunity to have those people on the phone correct him, and so I'm going to apologize in advance if I mangle them worse than Councillor Carra, who plays a lot of Scrabble and is much better than I am at his wordsmithing. And so if I could just be allowed a tiny bit more time, I want to really get through some of these things, if that's okay. We heard from many different people these past 4 days. So many people with so many different experiences and emotions. We heard from people that are totally broken. And they are broken because we broke them. Our system of racism broke Fareek Fraser. And Wumni Idowu. There were so many speakers. I just kind of wanted to pull out a couple of threads from a number of them that I really reflected on. Adam Messiah, your story of degradation and public assault deserves justice, and it has been denied, and I'm really sorry for that. People that I know and work with, Rachel Knight at the Calgary Parking Authority, Rachel Ugulbula, whose real last name I never knew. Fatima Saeed, the young middle school black woman who said, I'm afraid of the police when I see them in my school. Why are they in my school when there is no nurse in my school? No resources are provided to me that I need as a young woman minority. Why is there a police in my school when there's no nurse? Shauna Porter, for your righteous rage, as Dr. Smith yesterday so eloquently said, calls it. Dorsey Amanpour, for articulating budget discrepancies and how they reflect what we value and what we don't. Aiki Kenzo told us the story of the hummingbird in the forest fire and how I did what I could. Terrence Evans has a small informal group calling themselves Black Elders, and they are those little hummingbirds in our city. Ebony Gooden, the deaf woman, whose incredible voice on the inadequacies of access shook me at my core. Richard Blackman, the Indigenous man from Cold Lake whose personal stories of racism made me feel really ashamed. Lionel Magrino, the Filipino man with cerebral palsy, who in his statement said, I don't want to be seen as an inspiration. Rather, I am inspired by those who came before me. That was an incredible statement. Jordan Anderson, he drove here from Regina to tell his incredibly traumatic story about how he was afraid. He was waking up in the middle of the night angry, and that anger was starting to turn into his all-day life for something that he had nothing to do with, that has ruined him right now. Andy Wolfleg, your local restaurant is your local. That term is supposed to define comfort and safety. Almost all the TV shows, my white TV shows that I grew up with, anyway, but for you, your local wasn't that. And you kept on going back because it was your local, but you didn't know how they were gonna treat you depending on who was your server that day when you walked into your local. And that sucks. I have never had that, and I'm sorry for that. and Mr. Ram, who reminded me when we came in, Mr. Ram was on SATE, on the board, on the Students Association at SATE, who fought for secondary suite legalization. Your story bookends Adams of public degradation. This is a student leader who is publicly degraded in his neighborhood and who advocated for secondary suites to allow people to have affordable housing in our city. I've been shaken to my core again significantly, again since the conversion therapy hearings in May, and I need to be shaken. All of those in my position need to continue to be shook. So many speakers have been shaken their whole lives in big and small ways, and I want to acknowledge that my short journey is a speck to the individual and collective experience of Black and Indigenous and persons of color over hundreds of years. I am amazed and I have hope, and I'm really sad and I'm ashamed. The level of intelligence and courage and passion and sophistication from the speakers made me know that a better world is possible. And I want to lend my privileged power to that. You are all better equipped to wield that power, and I really want to offer it to you in an authentic way. Dr. Smith said, I believe it was this morning or yesterday evening, this morning, they showed up. They showed up. I pulled a number of themes that I think I just wanted to, hopefully, that we can take away. That people are deeply afraid of the very people that are supposed to protect them. And people are tired of being tired. The pieces on the name changing I found so troubling, the inability of you to be who you are just based on your name. And this process is inadequate, and we were told that over and over again. And it's funny that we, and Councillor Crowe, you and I say it all the time, just trust the process, trust the process. And I know that you actually shouldn't trust this process. There is very clearly systemic racism in our Calgary Police Service. We heard so many stories. Dr. Smith again said, you can't have so many stories that were about the same thing from people who had never met before. There is deep and structural reform that has to happen at the Calgary Police Commission, because we're supposed to be holding them to account. And what we've been told by hundreds of people is that that's not happening. And whether that's getting rid of school resource officers, I advocated 2 years ago when Western Canada High School was going to lose their school resource officer, I advocated to have him back, and I never, ever, ever knew that people thought this. That the police are doing the work of nurses and social workers. The DOPE team needs to get funded in the base budget. I'm sick every year of cobbling together one-time money for a service that the police are begging us for. We need to shift that around. There is very clearly systemic racism in the corporation of the City of Calgary. The representation at most of the tables in the city is a joke. And I'm responsible for that. We're all responsible for that. The top 50 managers at the City of Calgary, and not one, is a visible minority? The narrative of benevolence also hit me. I forget that. We think we're better. I read stories on Donald Trump and what's happening in America, and I think we're better. And we talked about a lot of our, we need to have a better understanding of our own local, deep histories of racism, but also deep histories of first, of firsts. I handed along, we had the first Black city councillor in the country. There's a fierce urgency to this work, and it cannot be crumbs of hope dropped from the tables of policymakers, is what one of our speakers said today, and I found that very profound. This has got to be real, and I'm committed to that. And I won't get into the role of the province and the Calgary Board of Education system in this, but we have to figure this out. My only final thoughts are, I just really wanted to thank the chair for all of his incredibly hard work. I've said this before, that sometimes we bug Giancarlo for being an inefficient chair, but for the last couple of chairings that you've done, you have been the most effective chair, and nobody else on council could have done this, done the job that you did. And Dr. Smith, I thank you. It's been really, really incredible 3 days. I am listening intently to every word, and I have such a great amount of respect for you, and I appreciate all of your work in helping us through this. We've got to hang out. Thank you for being in it for the long haul. I remember on day one, I said, you're in it for the long haul, and you went, ha, and then you committed, and it's been really, really great to get to know you over these last 3 days. Someone said, and I'm sorry I can't remember, but that we live in one of the best examples of pluralism in this world, but that that exists in conjunction with a system of structural racism and violence. And that's a crazy thing, and I've spent most of my, we spend a lot of time celebrating the pluralistic part, which I'm proud of, but we've left behind that other piece. And I just wanted to end off with Regine Uibere Yeho King, who is at the Faculty of Social Work at the University of Calgary, had a number of really neat things to say, but she had a quote, a Rwandan proverb that I just thought was telling for the close of my piece, that people don't fear darkness, they fear that what they have experienced in that darkness. And that is something that we have to address in a real, tangible way, and we have to hold ourselves to account for that work that's coming ahead. I thanks for the opportunity, Chair, and I obviously hope that everybody can support these recommendations.
Thank you. Powerful words, Evan. I think you did a great job of paying tribute to what we heard and trying to convey how that impacts people like us. Privilege, really. Thank you. Next up, I have Shane Keating.
Thank you, Chair. I'm certainly going to take very cautious words because I do believe that Councillor Woolley has said everything that there is to be said. But there is nothing I can say that would not diminish the experiences and the stories that we've heard over the last 3 days. So I want to make sure that as an individual who's almost 64, 65 and white, that we have to change systems without question. I also want to state that as a principal of a Catholic school for decades, I have taught every individual of race and every individual of religion across the board within my schools. So I would like to say that, and that's the preference to what I'm trying to say here, and I've raised this in council a couple times, that we have heard council members and we have heard senior administration use the term grumpy old white guy. I want to make sure, and all those who are on council will understand, that I'm always an individual talking about the whole rather than parts. I want to make sure that when we look at change, we understand. And Mr. Fontaine did mention in his opening, where he mentioned, and sometimes white, and also I hope I'm saying the name right, Ms. Orion Martin talked about a hierarchy of racism, not just a single aspect of racism, but a hierarchy, and it goes across the spectrum of our society. What we have to do is those, as Councillor Woolley said it, as privilege of power, we are willing to make sure that we will use whatever means we can to erase that privilege of power, and that we include the whole system in a change. We heard many, many stories. Like I said, I can say nothing, and I probably have said many things that have already tried to, in some people's minds, diminished what they say, and that's not the intent. As I've always done across my 10 years on council, is looking at the whole system in its entirety and making sure that we're fixing all parts. And I want to say my great thanks to the council members who have been able to stay on for the full length of this time, and to all of the participants who have come forward and shared their experience, and making sure that we call to action actually is action. And on that, Chair, I believe I will leave it. And I just want to thank you for your chairing and all the other members that are there, and the citizens once again for their stories. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor Keating. I have Diane Colley-Urquhart.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My deepest thanks goes to the 150 or 60 people that presented to us over the last 3 days, and to the hundreds and hundreds more who observed the proceedings. And I think it's a historic moment of City Council and City Administration in partnership with the community and our expert panel to have rolled this out in a short period of time. I knew when I left the chair after many years, Councillor Corral, that I was leaving things in very capable and experienced hands with you. Thank you. I'm not going to present my remarks tonight. I will at council. I need time to reflect and pull all this together based on my volunteer experience over many, many years with my service on the Alberta Human Rights Commission and chairing these hearings and working with Ron Gitter many, many years ago in the early 80s when he went across the province and heard about systemic racism and the white supremacist movement and all of that. So I won't bore you with the details of my involvement with this. And you know, my upbringing and being raised in a redneck family and how I learned so much in my nursing career, which is 50 years this year. So when I look at the recommendations, when I view this through the eyes of those that presented with their passionate and heartbreaking stories, when they look at these recommendations, and I understand that Mayor Nenshi wants to work on these on a go-forward basis, but they're pretty administrative. Approve committee terms of reference, direct what we heard into a report, direct that the committee come back in a year. I would like to see number three, Your Worship, when you rework these, that they come back with an interim report rather than 3 weeks before an election. People want to know, they need an update. We can't wait that long. So I'd like to see an interim report. Then they see, you know, approve the anti-racism capacity building. You know, for people that have had a torturous time with being discriminated against and excluded. So I'm going to just try this little amendment out. I've heard loud and clear after these many hours and 3 days, and I only missed 2 hours late this afternoon because of a personal commitment. But if we leave here tonight without acknowledging and recognizing that there is systemic racism within the City of Calgary and the Calgary Police Service, we will miss a huge opportunity for our community to realize that we are serious and we have listened to these stories and these concerns, and we are taking them to heart. So I want to put that up there. If you're not comfortable with it and you'd like more time to think about it, I understand. But I'm pretty serious about us making a bold, bold statement tonight that we acknowledge and we recognize that systemic racism exists within the city of Calgary and within the Calgary Police Service. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Cully Urquhart. That amendment is well put. I believe Mayor Nenshi wants to speak to the amendment.
Thank you for doing that, Councillor Collier Carts. One of the things that I have learned in these last 3 days is that in that carefully crafted by committee notice of motion that we passed, we made a mistake because we assumed that a systemic racism existed and we never actually said it did. So I think this is a very wise I'm very happy to have it. I'm wondering, Councillor Collier Cart, if you would accept a bit of a friendly to it. Because what we've written there is capital C, City of capital C, Calgary, our organization. And I think that we as leaders of the community can go even further than that. I think we can say that we acknowledge and recognize that systemic racism exists in our community, our government, our organization, and our institutions, including the city and the Calgary Police Service.
That's beautiful. Yeah. Especially because, Your Worship, when we hear from other orders of government that this isn't a problem, we have to make a strong statement like this. We've been asked very strongly for 3 days to advocate on behalf of our citizens, and we have our work cut out for us with other orders of government.
Mayor Nenshi, can you please review what's on the screen?
I'll send it to the clerk.
Okay, we're going to send you the clerk and Councillor Gondek.
Thank you, Chair. On the amendment, I would ask for professional courtesy if we're naming one of our partners, that being the Calgary Police Service, that we either check in with the Chief of Police and or Chair Croft. I think that would be appropriate. Or if you make reference to the statement they issued today where they clearly acknowledge this. I want to make sure that this is coming from the organization that we're naming rather than us naming it on their behalf. I would ask that out of professional courtesy, please. So depending on which way that's best taken.
I'll address that in my close, but I'd like to hear what my other colleagues have to say about that, actually.
Yeah, I mean, I'll just weigh in from the chair right now, and I have a tremendous amount of respect for what Councillor Gondek is suggesting. It's acknowledging that the Calgary Police Service has acknowledged in their statement today that there is systemic racism within their organization. But I'm not sure that that's a necessary professional courtesy, given the fact that we just spent 3 days hearing from the community that pretty clearly that systemic racism this is the finding of this hearing. So personally, I don't think that's a professional courtesy that is both unnecessary and counter to the spirit of the proceedings we just went through. So with an abundance of respect, I would, argue that we need to not do that as a more meaningful statement than do it as a meaningful statement. But I appreciate that, Councillor Gondek. I'd be interested to hear what the rest of committee has to say. Is there anyone at home who wants to weigh in on the amendment?
Davison and Keating.
Councillor Davison, I had you up to speak on the main, but I'm going to let you speak just on the motion right now.
Thank you. Yeah, on the main was what my intent was. But in reading this, I would argue that by stating the city of Calgary, we are fully and eyes wide open, looking to examine the systemic racism that exists in all our city departments. And so would agree that we'd heard many things today about 311, 911, Calgary Police Service, Calgary Fire Department, QP Local 32, or 37, I believe it was. I think by stating City of Calgary, it's recognition that we have to examine each and every department, not just specific ones. So that's my two cents on that.
Are you proposing either an amendment to what's before us, or are you just suggesting you will vote against the...
I would say including all departments within the City of Calgary.
That's what it's. That's what it says. Are you looking to strike Calgary Police Service from this, Councillor Davison?
Well, I don't think that is what it says. I think it says our organization and our institutions, including the City of Calgary, and you could say, and all departments within.
See, okay, let's. I think the I'm going to interrupt you and just say I think the mayor has sent the actual wording. So let's see the actual wording.
I'm looking at what's on the screen.
Yeah, so, I am too, and it occurs to me that that is the actual wording. Okay.
Okay, then I would say just including all City of Calgary departments.
So are you attempting to amend this by saying including all City of Calgary departments and striking that from the Calgary Police Service?
Well, just procedurally, you need to recognize that the Calgary Police Service is not a department of the City of Calgary.
Well, then that's the thing. Yeah.
So you're.
Okay. You know what? I'm not going to make the amendment. Just leave it as is, and we'll see where this goes. Okay. Thank you.
Councillor Gondek, are you looking to make an amendment?
The only reason I raise this is because this says that this standing policy committee recommends that council acknowledges and recognizes that systemic racism exists in all of these organizations. One of these organizations came out with a public statement and said, yep, we feel that systemic racism exists. That's not being acknowledged here. I would like that acknowledged. That's all I'm saying. You don't have to strike Calgary Police Service. I'm not saying you should do that. But I do think, out of respect for the statement they issued, acknowledging that their organization accepts that systemic racism exists. That's all I want to do.
I understand now. So I think you could add a few words at the end then, including the City of Calgary and the acknowledgement by the Calgary Police Service.
Yes. However,
Yeah.
You want to fix it up, I think it's absolutely important that an organization that listened to 3 days of public hearings and understood their impact on the community and the need to change should be recognized.
I'm going to weigh in.
Okay.
I'm going to weigh in from the chair and just say that if they truly acknowledge that, then the fact that, then they should probably not stand on the ceremony of having acknowledged that. They should just agree with that statement.
Yeah.
And I think it's unnecessary. And I'm going to just make that point of argument. I think it waters down the power of what we heard from the citizens.
Yeah.
And so I would highly recommend, as much as I respect what Councillor Gondek's trying to do, I don't want to in any way water down the power of what we heard from the citizens, especially if the Calgary Police Service agrees.
Yeah, it's a done deal. So you're thinking, just call that separately then. The acknowledgement by the, call that separately as an amendment to the amendment then to see what our colleagues think.
Are you going to, okay, so if you want to test committee's will on this, Councillor Gondek, I will accept your amendment, the acknowledgement by. Wait, let's see if we can fix.
Point of order. Well, I appreciate this, and I think this is super important note to make. One of the ideas of us leaving this as is to council is that everybody's tired, and we're going to come out with a bad product if we muck with this too much. Right? If there is an amendment to be made, then make the amendment. But I just, we're already losing steam on the closing arguments that we're supposed to have. I think everybody can acknowledge this, but wordsmithing a powerful statement from this committee right now, I think, would do a great disservice. And the police have acknowledged it. I think it's, I just, through the chair, okay. Let's not lose the momentum of this.
I don't want to lose the momentum either, Councillor.
So if there's no amendment put, then what are we trying to figure out? So if someone has to put an amendment, then put an amendment.
Do you want to put that amendment or not? Okay, Councillor Gondek is well within her rights to put that amendment.
What is the amendment?
The amendment is the words, the acknowledgement by.
Just sent Councillor Gondek a note. What you should, if you want to do this amendment, what you should do is say, after Calgary Police Service, comma, as acknowledged by the joint statement by the Calgary Police Service, the Calgary Police Association, the Calgary Police Commission, and the Senior Officers Association.
That's actually what I asked for the first time. Thank you.
Okay. So write that out, and then we'll vote on it.
I wrote it out. I'll send it to the clerk.
Stand by for cut and paste, clerk.
There we go.
Chair, it's Councillor Keating here.
Councillor Keating.
Yes, I'm not sure if you saw, I had my request in because I wholeheartedly agree with Councillor Gondek. If we're looking at the system as a whole, and if we're going to start respecting all parts of the system, then we must acknowledge when a part comes out and categorically states that they're willing to address and they believe that there's systematic racism within their department. We have to acknowledge that.
Okay.
Either that or we leave out including the CPS. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else at home, anyone else dialed in that would like to speak to the amendment, the underlined portion there?
It's Councillor Collier Card. I'll speak to the amendment.
This is the amendment to the amendment, Councillor Collier Card.
Yes. Could I speak to it?
Yes.
So I'm good with this amendment, and I'll tell you why. The amendment to the amendment. Let me tell you why. And I always bore my colleagues with my history, but I think sometimes it's helpful. So I was a civilian commissioner, police commissioner in the early 90s, and then another 9 or 10 years more recently. And there's been a lot of criticism of our Calgary Police Service over the last 3 days. And we can't throw the baby out with the bathwater, so to speak. I have watched the growth and the partnership that the Police Service of Calgary have formed with the community. The reason I wasn't here the last 2 hours before supper was that I was visiting Source, which is right across the street, which is a multi-agency collaboration that the police initiated. And it was Deputy Chief Trevor DeRue that started it. And it's phenomenal. The partnerships that the police have formed over these many, many years to serve the community is incredible. It's an untold story that needs to be told to a greater extent. So we can all do better. And this is a powerful statement that the police service, the police association, and the senior officers association, you know, set aside the commission. But for those three bodies to make a powerful statement that they've been listening and they have heard the community is really, really incredible. It's a defining moment. That's why I think it's so important to be here. So, you know, there will come a day when we will deal with some of the other issues that we've heard about. We're in this together. These are City of Calgary employees that work at the Calgary Police Service. And this, to me, this number one amendment and amendment to the amendment is probably the most powerful thing we could do at this moment in time. So I would ask us all if we could just please all unanimously support it. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Collier-Urquhart. Mayor Nenshi, on the amendment to the amendment.
Thanks, Chair. Councillor Collier-Urquhart, you just about almost convinced me with that. But I actually am going to say that if this amendment passes, it's fine. It's still a powerful statement. I will not be voting for it. The reason I will not be voting for it is after everything we heard today, we have to sit, and yesterday and the day before, we sit as the voice of the community. Mm-hmm. And I think it's okay for us to say as the voice of the community, whether or not the police acknowledge it, we acknowledge it, that we believe mm-hmm. that this is in place. And I think that's an important statement to make because, yes, Councillor Davison, we heard about the Human Resources Department. We heard about 911. We heard about the fire department. We heard shocking things about the fire department. But we heard a lot about the police. And I did not hear anyone say that Calgary neighborhoods makes me feel unsafe to be a citizen of Calgary. I didn't hear them say that Calgary Parks makes me feel unsafe to be a neighbor of Calgary, a citizen of Calgary, or that the finance department makes me feel that way, or the payroll department. But we heard a lot about the Calgary Police Service. So if this passes, this is fine. And the big, big thing about this, as Councillor Collier-Urquhart said, is that the Calgary Police Association and the Senior Officers Association signed on to this statement. That is not something we're seeing across North America right now. It is a big deal, and it should be acknowledged. And I'm very pleased to have seen it happen. I also think that we can simply say, as people who speak for the community, that this exists. So I don't mind it. It's fine to put it there because it's acknowledging something important, but I will be voting against it.
Mm-hmm. Councillor Woolley.
Yeah, thank you. For much of the reasons that the mayor said as well, I think it takes away from us making a strong statement as those who are most accountable directly to our citizens. You know, I've had a lot of people, and remember that this joint statement came out about 2 hours ago, before we'd actually even ended hearing from all of the members of the community. But a number of people had reached out and said, there's a point in this that we work to improve public safety for citizens and enhance confidence. And I don't, what we have heard is that from hundreds of people is a total lack of no confidence. And I think someone said 0 times 2 is still 0. And this isn't about enhancing confidence. This is about trying to rebuild trust to have any confidence. And so we need to make this statement as those most accountable for all of our citizens. And this is an unnecessary watering down of this strong statement.
Anyone else to debate? I'm going to debate before I hand it over to Councillor Gondek to close. And I would say I'm going to try. Oh, Councillor Sutherland. Okay, Councillor Sutherland, please go.
Thank you. I'll be very brief. I'll be supporting the amendment. I do not think it waters anything down. In fact, I think it does the opposite. I can't recall, and probably then Councillor Collier-Urquhart could over the many years, that you have all the different associations within the police service saying the same thing. And I think it's historic that they're all saying the same thing together. And to say it's watering down, well, it's step one. Step one is acknowledging this exists. And if you don't even acknowledge it, that it doesn't exist, nothing can ever change. And this organization has just said, we acknowledge it and we have to do something about it. So I think we need to give them the recognition, the fact they're all saying they acknowledge that this problem is here. And that's step one. Thank you.
Councillor Chu.
Thank you, Chair. I totally agree. I'm going to support this. And it's very important. I said that so many times, is that the first, we have to acknowledge that there's an issue. And the Calgary Police Service is doing that. And the higher level, Canada is doing that. The whole society is doing that. A lot of places, like being a colored person, an immigrant, and police officer for 21 years, is the police service perfect? No. Can I get better?
why they recognize it and they're working in the diversity resourcing unit for many years to try to do the best they can to bring this to the attention and try to fix the issue. And many people talk today and they didn't say, I didn't hear much to say about Canada is a very tolerant place. Don't get me wrong, there is racism. I have experienced myself too. But on the other hand, if Calgary is such a racist city, don't forget, we have 40% councillors on council. We are minority or bisexual as well. And what does that say? People keep saying that we got to be proportional. Well, 38%, we're at 40 right now. It shows that Calgarian, majority of the Calgarian is not racist whatsoever. And for the police department, they're trying to do the best they can. In my opinion, did I have a bad experience? Yes, I did. But let me tell you, overwhelming majority of the people, even retired, I've seen the store, they came up to me, say hi to me, pat me on the shoulder. If this is such bad place, why is that we have the very high rating, I don't remember now, the 80 percentile in satisfaction in Calgary? And I don't think we fixed that, you know, in a bad way. It's true numbers. If this is such a bad thing, I don't think we get that kind of number. And again, racism does exist. And that's why we, first of all, we had to, that's why they're fixing it. And Kelly, like you said, the association and the senior association, they all came out to say the same thing. That's never happened. And let's put it on the table. Tell the public, we need the trust of the police, because when you're in trouble, who are you going to call? Right? So that's send a message to the public, to Calgarians and North America. Hey, our police department, from the top to the bottom, everybody is thinking the same thing. Yes, that's a problem. Let's fix this together. And I thank them too, not being in chamber or being online, letting people know they're there. Because many times when I was working, I don't put a uniform on because for this same very, some people came from the place, they are afraid of police. And the police are doing the best. Again, is there people doing the wrong thing? Definitely. That's pointing out those people. Get them fired if necessary. And I'm 100% on that. And because the bad reputation of the police, meaning that I'm a retired police officer, I'm going to get bad rap too. I don't want that. So this is very important in my opinion. Please, council, let's support this. This is our institution, the very important institution. That's why we spend so much money on it. Why? If you don't have law and order, guess what? The place I came from, everybody has a metal bar on their door. How many people has that in Calgary? Maybe few. I have seen few. But why? Because we're a law and order country and the city. And some people might have a bad experience with the police, but majority still think that policing is a very, very important institution and the tool to make a Calgary vibrant city on every aspect. So I think it's very important, and please support this. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Chu. I believe we have Councillor Davison on a point of procedure.
Yes,
I mean, a point of order.
Point of order. Just procedurally, you know, this has been an incredibly emotional process for everyone. And I think that a lot of us really haven't had the time to digest a lot of what we've heard. And so how do we allow ourselves the time to consider
everything we've gone through in the last 3 days. Because I really think what's critical is that we get this right and not confuse the public over the nuance of our recommendations. I think that ship sailed,
Councillor Davidson.
Well, I guess if the important piece here is to be aligned, as we've seen and done in other committees, we can table these recommendations and we can move them to council. Because that's really where we're going to ratify the recommendations. So okay. If we think that there are additions to be made in the coming days, or that reflection is part of the process, I think we're walking a fine line here of trying to cram through some recommendations, do we take our time?
I would say, are you moving to refer this to council? Before you answer that question, I'm going to let Mayor Nenshi weigh in.
Thanks, Councillor Carra. Thanks, Mr. Chair. As you said at the beginning, I think the intent is precisely what Councillor Davidson is saying, that things will shift a little bit between now and council. But I think what is really important is what Councillor Collier-Cart said. And I tried to talk her out of it. And she was, as she usually is, correct when she pushed back on me. Because I said I didn't want to get into this procedural stuff today. We can do a little bit of that offline like we did with the Green Line and come back with a new set of recommendations at council. But Councillor Collier-Cart said, and I think it's incredibly important, we're not getting out of this room until we acknowledge the systemic racism. And so I agree with Councillor Davidson that we're going to do some work on this going forward. I think after these 3 days, it would be an incredible disservice to the people that we have heard from to not pass this as one of the recommendations that then goes forward to council.
So that's the mayor's political advice to you, Councillor Davidson. Are you going to, in the face of that, move a referral or not?
Well, I think, it's important to have that debate. I don't really know what I want to do. And to be quite honest, I don't really know that I feel comfortable tabling or doing anything right now.
Okay.
Hang on a second. I'd like to explain myself. And if you could stop cutting me off, that would be fantastic. Because we've heard a lot of commentary from you. And I would like to explain myself if that's possible. The challenge I have here is that I want to be seen doing something. I also don't want to be seen doing the wrong thing. I fear saying the wrong thing. I fear communicating and doing the wrong thing. And I feel like we haven't had a lot of time to reflect on everything we've gone through in the last few days. And so if we're trying to say we've got to be seen doing something, that's one thing. I don't know what to do here. And so I guess I'm looking to have the debate rather than just at the end of 3 days, rush something on the floor and give ourselves a pat on the back and get on with our day here.
Okay, so this is you on a point of order. I appreciate your rumination. What would you like to do? Are you going to cede the floor or would you like to...
Sure, I'll cede the floor because I think it's an idea and honestly I don't know what to do with it.
Okay, thank you. I just want to let the... I will debate and then I will hand it back to Jyoti Gondek to close on the amendment to the amendment. And I would like to sort of build on the arguments that we heard from Mayor Nenshi and Evan Woolley, and also I think vibe off of some of the rumination that Councillor Davidson shared with us on his point of order. And that is this. I haven't been looking at Twitter right now, but I can only imagine that everyone who's been following along is feeling a little gut punched by how we're doing exactly what I was hoping we wouldn't do, which is the wet work of legislation when it's time to make a powerful statement. I am completely convinced that the main amendment to was an omission, and we absolutely should have acknowledged. And I thank Councillor Collier-Cart for bringing the main amendment forward. Have to acknowledge that systemic racism exists. If we heard anything from the public, it's that. I do think that this amendment is—it's like a little metaphor of the larger problem, which is that we're losing our thunder to make a big statement. And Councillor And I agree that the fact that the police commission, the police association, the senior officers association, all signed on to this statement is a great step in a North American context where Black Lives Matter. But I'm going to debate Councillor Sutherland's argument that this is part of step one. Step one was hearing from the public, and we're still in step one. Step two is the police department or the police service responding to what they heard, and they've done that before we've taken step one. Step three is bringing it together. The community, who we're representing here, and the police commission, who's responding to the community, that's step three. And to try and put them together would be a disservice to the process that we have to take. So I absolutely think we should support the amendment, but we should not support the amendment to the amendment because it gets ahead of where we have to be, and everyone's freaked out about taking a wrong step and saying the wrong thing. This is the wrong thing at the wrong time. Please do not support it. I'll turn it over to Councillor Gondek for her close.
So holding an organization to account for something that it has made a commitment to is a significantly different thing than telling an organization what it is. With this amendment, we hold these organizations accountable for the words that they put in writing and released publicly. That's important to me. And there's been a lot of talk about losing the thunder and the power of this committee. It's a disservice to the process. I will tell you something. I'm the only woman of color on this council. I was appointed by this council to serve on police commission. If you don't think that I have worked my butt off for the last 3 days to work with these organizations to help them understand what acknowledgement would mean, and they willingly made a statement, I had to do no coercing because they listened to the people that came here. There is nothing more powerful than these four groups representing the Calgary Police Service coming forward and saying, we heard people who have felt unheard. I did my job that I was brought here to do. And to say that I am wordsmithing and watering things down, I will take the responsibility for doing what I had to do, and I hope, committee, that you will recognize how important it is that these organizations took accountability for having to change. Please support this.
I would just like to rise on a point of privilege for a moment. I had one of the names of the signatures on this release is Chair Bonita Croft from the Calgary Police Commission. And in a conversation late this afternoon, I said, have you been listening in to the voices of this city? And I was told, no, I was not able to listen. I said, so you didn't listen to any of them? And the answer was, I was unable to listen to any of the voices in the community that came to speak to us. And that's why I rose on a point of privilege. I wasn't going to say anything. But to have this go out in the last minute, I think is very unfortunate, particularly when I was made aware of that. And I find that to be deeply, deeply problematic. And I'll leave it at that.
Okay.
Point of privilege, Chair.
We are
talking about an individual who's not here. This is frankly hearsay. This person can't even defend themselves. And that is one person out of four organizations that came together. I find it troubling that we are now pointing fingers at people. Don't forget that individual also has a day job and volunteers.
Yeah, that's fine. I don't think that was the point that Councillor Woolley was making on his rising on a point of privilege. It's sort of an unorthodox thing to do right after the close. But I'm going to accept it as the chair because I think it's extremely pertinent and it is a point of privilege. I appreciate the fact that I don't think he was making the point that the chair had to listen to this. And but I accept your acknowledgement of that. All right.
Well, he totally did.
It's closed. I will call to question on the amendment to the amendment, which is the underlined portion of the statement number one. Only the underlined portion. All in favor? Opposed? Call the roll, Madam Clerk.
On the amendment, to the amendment, Councillor Farkas? Councillor Farrell?
No.
Councillor Gondek?
Yes.
Councillor Jones? Councillor Keating?
Yes.
Councillor Magliocca?
Yes.
Councillor Sutherland?
Yes.
Councillor Woolley?
No.
Councillor Carra?
No.
Councillor Shahal?
No.
Councillor Chu?
Yes.
Councillor Collier-Cart?
Yes.
Councillor Davison?
Yes.
Councillor DeMong?
Yes.
Mayor Nenshi? That is carried.
Okay.
Five. Thank you.
On the amendment, as amended, any further debate, or do I hand it to Councillor Collier-Cart to close? Councillor Collier-Cart to close.
Thank you, colleagues. I'll be brief. I think this debate we just had was very, very important. And to proceed now with the amended amendment that's before us, and for all those that are listening that presented, this is a defining moment in the history of our city, and it will make a broad and bold statement, not only across the province, but the country. I don't know of any other city or municipality or county that has made a statement like this. And I know how important that those two words are after 3 days of public hearings. So I know from what I've heard from my colleagues that we're all united on this, that any one of us could have written this amendment. So with that, I'm closed and thank you.
Madam Clerk, call the roll, please.
On the amendment as amended, Councillor DeMong. Councillor Farkas?
Yes.
Sorry, my apologies. Councillor Farkas? Councillor Farrell?
Yes.
Councillor Gondek?
Yes.
Councillor Jones? Councillor Keating?
Yes.
Councillor Magliocca?
Yes.
Councillor Sutherland?
Yes.
Councillor Woolley?
Yes.
Councillor Shahal?
Yes.
Councillor Chu?
Yes.
Councillor Collier-Cart?
Yes.
Councillor Davidson?
Yes.
Mayor Nenshi?
Yes.
Councillor Carra?
Yes.
That is carried unanimously. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor Collier-Cart. On the main,
you're welcome.
I just want to say that I'm really sad that the procedural wet work derailed the incredible start to the ruminations on what we've spent the last 3 days hearing that Councillor Woolley set up, that Councillor Keating continued. Very important amendment, though. Thank you, Councillor Collier-Cart. I have Jeff Davison up next. Closing statement.
Sure. Thanks, Chair. I'll be brief. The one thing that kind of struck me over the last few days is that we often pat ourselves on the back that Calgary is one of the most livable places in the world. But I can tell you over the last few days, it certainly didn't leave me with that impression or feeling. It was uncomfortable, and frankly, it should have been. But it was also incredibly moving to listen and learn about the realities that thousands of Calgarians face each and every day. I want to commend the speakers for their courage to address inequality and racism in all its forms. And just can't imagine how hard it has been and continues to be in sharing these deeply personal experiences. A huge thank you to Dr. Smith and Mr. DeBreo for being present. And, you know, thank you for sticking it out with us over the last few days. Your expertise and your knowledge and your wisdom, we really look forward to working with you guys on next steps through this process. But for today, I think I'll simply say that I certainly support these recommendations. And in the time between now and council, certainly plan on reflecting on all the learnings of the past few days and how, you know, we consider as elected officials and lawmakers here in Calgary that we can collectively and how I can personally promote active anti-racism in our city. And so just a thanks to everybody who made the time to participate in this incredibly historic process. Thanks.
Thank you, Councillor Davison. Councillor Chu.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, sorry. I just changed headset. Okay, so just want to say that, yes, there are racism. But however, I just want to say, I don't hear anybody saying, I just want to say that thanks to Canada for allowing me and my family to immigrate here. And many millions of immigrants come to Canada. And also Calgary are very, very tolerant people. Again, because we have 40% on council are visible minority or bisexual as well. Can we do better? Of course we can do better. However, unintentionally spelling or pronouncing someone's names wrong aren't racism. And also, only allow a speaker to speak for 5 minutes. That's the rule. That's not a racism. And also, people didn't vote for me. I don't think that means that they're racist because they didn't vote for me because I'm a minority. It's up on me to convince people because I didn't do a better job to convince how many percent there's people that they didn't vote for me. So I will be supporting this. And I just want to say that, again, Canada is a very tolerant country. And thank you, Canada. Every Canada Day, I thank God that I'm here. And what an equal opportunity, which I worked very hard to be a police officer and working hard for 21 years and working very hard to be elected in Calgary. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Chu. Councillor Gondek, I have you on the list.
Thank you, Chair. What we heard from most people that came and presented to us is that they didn't want to hear from us. It was their turn to talk. It was our turn to listen. And they didn't want to hear how we could relate to them because that's not what this was about. They didn't want to hear about our experiences because that's not what this was about. We were here to listen. Listen is what we did. And we are now taking action. This was messy. It was necessarily messy because we've never done this before. An acknowledgement of this nature is, it's impossible to do because the systemic racism we're trying to combat is rooted in a system we're trying to use to combat it. That's impossible. I am grateful to the people who came and spoke. I've listened and I need to be so much better. I started this off thinking I could relate to you and understand you and you would trust me to help you. I have so much more trust earning to do, even though I've been in many of your situations. We will do the best we can. It's gonna be ugly. buckle up.
Thank you, Councillor Gondek. Councillor Farrell, would you like to offer a statement?
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Chair, for chairing this meeting with patience and pathos. I've been in a lot of hearings over my years, and I think this one is the most meaningful and the most painful. I heard so much anger and so much pain from our neighbors, from the people we share our city with. And not all of us experience the city in the same way. And we will be judged by our actions. This is a movement that I don't think we can be the same. I don't want to be the same. So if we, and I've been through many anti-racism policies, equity policies, and they really haven't made a big difference in people's lives. If we don't make a difference in the way people experience their city in an equitable way, we will have failed as a council. And so let's hold each other to account. That this is the moment. This is the moment in history where we can make a difference. If we don't, then shame on us. So I want to thank all the people who spoke and exposed their darkest moments. I wish we could have done it differently. I wish that we could have moved forward without all that pain. But today we have an opportunity. And please, Council, let's not squander it. Let's not forget this moment as we move forward with action. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Farrell. In the spirit of this not being a normal meeting, we are joined here at the table by a member of the community, by two members of the community. And I'd like to offer a Niall the Braille, who's been here since the very beginning and all through it with us, a moment to offer some reflection.
Thank you.
I'm going to interrupt you, if I may.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Why don't we let Council finish? Because I think I would like to hear from Niall and Dr. Smith as the last speakers of this.
That's not what I heard from them, but if you would like that, we can do that instead.
I mean, it's not what I would like, but I would like to end this. I mean, it is what I would like, but it's not about the fact that I would like it. But we've heard from the community so much in the last 3 days, and it just feels right to me, instead of finishing with the mayor in a close like we always do, to finish with the authentic voice of the community as represented by these two extraordinary people who've been with us.
I'm not against that. Is that okay with the two of you? Pressure's on now.
I'd actually like to just speak right now. I think the leadership by this council has been great, and I'm fine to defer to it. But if you want me to have the last word, or I defer to Dr. Smith, but please just let me know. Just let me know.
I'm going to go with the mayor. I'm just
first time for everything.
Yeah, first time I go with the mayor. All right. We'll finish the procedural matter, and then we will end with reflections from our representatives from the community. Okay. That leaves Mayor Nenshi up next, unless you'd like me to go before you, sir. Councillor Chahal is going last. We're the last three people.
If you don't mind, go ahead. I'm still collecting my thoughts.
Okay. I will try and speak.
The mayor should go last.
Well, Councillor Chahal has to go last because he's the mover. But I will.
Sorry, Chahal.
All right. I will say that I never really intended to become a politician. And now I'm 10 years into the job. And I've spent almost as much time as a politician as I did in the career that led me to city politics, which was sustainable urban design, community building community activism. And I came to City Hall with a platform called Great Neighborhoods. And it's based on the simple and compelling idea that great neighborhoods make a great city. And a great neighborhood is a place for people of all ages, all stages, all wages. And in a pluralistic project like Calgary, people of all backgrounds as well. And I fundamentally believe that how we build our city physically can contribute to the justness and the equity and the accessibility and the inclusiveness of the society that we're building together. Neighborhoods are places, but they're also people. And as we've learned through 3 days, they're also the intersectional relationship between people, place, and institutional structures. And so I can tell you that the urban design movement that I've been a part of, the New Urbanism, for 30 years, I sent my amazing staff virtually to the Congress for the New Urbanism, and so much of what that movement is talking about now are matters of inclusivity, matters of anti-racism, because it's essential that when we build our communities together as physical and social constructs, that we're extremely thoughtful. And so I have, this dovetails with my fundamental work, and I want to give a shout out to Bethel Athelwork, who spoke so eloquently about zoning as a structure of systemic racism. And I will tell everybody who's been watching, it's really the power of your municipal government, the power that actually resides in this order of government, is the power to shape the city we live in together. And we all have to plug in to how that works. I also want to give a shout out to Jeremy John Escobar Torrio, who spoke about environmental justice, environmental racism, as one of the systems of structural racism, and how the city we build is a product of alleviating or ensconcing structural racism, systemic racism. And he also tied it to climate change, which is a critically important thing to do too in this time and age. If COVID-19 has taught us anything, it's that we're all in this together, and we have to not only think globally and act locally, but also act globally as we work together. And I fundamentally believe that the neighborhood's the place where that happens. And I'm so proud that movements talking about local democracy and inclusivity, and movements talking about physically building our cities equitably, are merging at this point in history throughout the world, and it's happening right here. And we are in the process of overhauling our zoning codes and our policy for building great communities for everyone. And I encourage everyone who spent time talking about races to get involved in that as well, because it's critically important. One of the things that I heard over the course of this debate is how different racism manifests itself south of the border and here in Canada. And, you know, we've acknowledged that as urban designers and city builders for a while. We always say that when you go into a community in the States and you want to talk about neighborhood change, you face an angry mob and you're in a fight from the moment you get there. And when you try and do the same thing in a Canadian context, everyone's really smiley and nice and there's no fight. And then when you turn around, they knife you in the back. And that's exactly what I heard from people about the experience of racism in Canada. It seems a lot nicer, but when you're not looking, when you least expect it, that's when you get knifed. And it's interesting to me that the same thing is experienced in the project of city building. I came into this thinking I had a very strong handle on systemic racism in our community, systems of oppression. But I also knew that I was going to get a serious masterclass, to use Dr. Smith's compelling term, in the difference between theory and practice. And I did. And I'm exhausted and uncomfortable and beaten up by that. And as Councillor Willie said, that is a moon cast shadow compared to the deep weight that so many, too many of our neighbors experience. I have been a big supporter of our police service over the years as a best and brightest example of community policing, of a police force that works with the community and not at the community in a North American context. And that might be true, Councillor Chu, but oh my goodness, if you are not convinced that we have a long way to go to make it right and to live up to the ideals that we think, I mean, you want to talk about a gap between theory and practice? That was a serious, that was for me the biggest surprise. That was my biggest experience of privilege. And we can't do that. And something that I've been asking myself when I heard people, older people who have been in this fight for decades, say, I did not think that my children would have to be dealing with what I had to deal with in this day and age. I wonder, and I've got two questions, you know, is it that it's just we're Canadian and nice and it's sort of hidden and it's always been there? Or is it getting worse? And the mayor said both, and I agree. The answer is yes. And I want to dig in a little bit to it getting worse. The question, are we sliding backwards? I was elected in 2010 alongside our amazing mayor, and I say, to use his term, it was a period of politics in full sentences. I always tell people, I was elected in an age of politics in full sentences. And now I'm enduring an age of a politics of anger and fear and division. And I believe that democracy, the same way there is a pathogen in the human herd, COVID-19, I believe there's pathogens trying to kill our project of democracy. And for a long time now, I've been talking about two vectors of disease in our democracy. One of them is weaponized misinformation. There is a deliberate attempt by bad actors to destroy our unifying objective reality, a conceptual, our ability to both plug into a conceptual reality. And I'm glad, as traumatic as it was, that we had one dude show up to make the lame case that, in fact, white people in our society are victim of black racism, and it's not the other way around. That is so bizarre. But you know what? That is happening. That is a disease that is afflicting our project of democracy. The fact that we are being split into groups that can look at the same objective reality and tell each other completely antithetical stories. And that is something that we are being manipulated into. We are being divided and driven apart by weaponized misinformation in a very deliberate way. It's the craft of old school propaganda, enhanced by brain science. We now understand that the human brain has blind spots a mile wide, and people are exploiting that, and supercharged by social media. The other thing that's killing democracy is a disease from within, and it's the permanent campaign. The whole project is based on the idea that we will have periodic competitions of ideas for the right to govern. And now we govern as an act of permanent competition. The script has been flipped. And those two things are killing us. And you know, and I thought that was it, those two things. But I thought that weaponized misinformation was merely a tool of the permanent campaign. But two history professors at Yale University, Stephen Levitsky and Daniel Ziblatt, a couple months ago published a book called How Democracies Die. And their theory their historical analysis is that there has never been a democracy in the history of Western democracy that has successfully survived the transition of its founding cultural ethnic group, transitioning from the majority of the population into a plurality of the population. And that when the dominant establishing group is in danger of no longer controlling the majority share, they dismantle the democracy rather than share power across different peoples. And I would suggest to you that that division is exactly what's happening right now. And it explains the rise of Trump, and it explains Brexit, and explains the rise of racist, overt racism, clinging to the structures of structural racism, the skeletal systems of structural racism that we should be working to demolish. So I want to thank, you know, COVID-19 in some ways could be a blessing in disguise. Black Lives Matter, the senseless killing George Floyd, is also not that senseless if it rises up and allows us to mobilize against these forces that are killing us, that are killing what we're trying to do here together, which is build a great, pluralistic, equal, inclusive society together. So I think that we have a historic moment to act. We have momentum, and we need to act, and everything we do has to significantly change the game. I want to note that on top of refining what's coming to council on the 20th, we're also going to email every single person who spoke and thank them, and sort of give them a little bit of a rundown on what's coming and how to stay tuned, plugged in. And what comes after the 20th, when we take our commitment to action and make it policy and law, is that we have to build deep ties with this incredible community that's come together. So I want to thank everybody who did that, who came together and shared over the last 3 days with us. The only other thanks I want to give before I cede the floor to Mayor Nenshi is I want to thank our administrative teams and our clerks teams. I want to thank my incredible team in my office and the mayor's incredible team who worked so hard to help make today and yesterday and the day before these proceedings happen. And the last thanks I just want to give is to Jean, who's made this transition to a semi-digital world really work. Well, Gene and his team. Well, you're just the face of it, Gene, but we really appreciate you. All right, well, I think we've got work to do, but I think it's really exciting, and I'm very hopeful. And with that, I'll turn it over to Mayor Nenshi.
Thank you so much, Chair. I have been sitting here debating back and forth. Do I want to do a big speech? Do I want to do a big speech now? Do I want to wait till council and do a big speech? I don't know. So I don't know what's going to happen in the next couple of minutes, because I am sitting here in a mess of emotions. I'm heartbroken. I'm angry. I'm not surprised. I'm shocked in some things I heard, but I'm not surprised by what we heard today. I'm exhausted in a way that I don't normally allow myself to be exhausted. But I'm also living in a moment of extraordinary gratitude and extraordinary pride in so much of what we built here in our community. I'm proud of everyone in this room. I'm proud of Melanie and Katie and your teams for what you've done to bring us together in a conversation we've never had before. I'm proud of the folks who make this happen every day. I'm proud of my council colleagues for what they just did in acknowledging the existence of real racism in this place that we talk so well about, that we are so proud of every single day. I'm exceptionally proud of you, my brother, Mr. Chair, at the work that you've done. You know, as we went through COVID, a lot of people said, will council be able to do any work during this time period? And some city councils stopped meeting, and they just did the necessary. They just did the stuff to keep the wheels on the bus. And we said, we will continue to do our work because citizens expect that of us. And you, sir, have led us through not one but two extraordinary moments for our community. So Councillor Carrott and I had a bit of a set-to on the Friday before all of this started. Not really a set-to, because he agreed, as he always does, that I was right. But he had said that this was going to be a historic moment. And I said, it's not a historic moment, Giancarlo. It's a meeting. But it might be the beginning of something historic. And I still believe that. But I also still believe now that it is historic. Folks, I want you to think about one thing. I've been sitting in that chair for 10 years almost. I have presided over thousands and thousands of public hearings. And the number of people of color, of Black people and of Indigenous people that we've heard from in the last 3 days is an order of magnitude higher than the number of Black people, Indigenous people, and people of color that I have seen in this room in 10 years. And that is something, because it means there's a community that we're not hearing as we sit here and as we make these decisions. You know, when you hear me talk about COVID, I often talk about one of my big learnings, which I always knew, but I never really talked about before. That right here in this city, in this extraordinary place, we've allowed the creation of an economic underclass of people, almost all of whom are first-generation immigrant and refugee women, who get up very early in the morning and take the bus to work, and they go to work to wake up our grandparents, to change their diapers, and to feed them breakfast. And they only get 30 hours a week because nobody wants to pay them benefits. So in addition to getting up that early and going to work, they go to their second job at night and do the night shift and put our grandparents to bed. And when an outbreak breaks out, we blame them. We say, how are you doing these two different jobs? How are you spreading this virus, spreading this pandemic? But if not for the pandemic, we would not be in this moment. We would not be in this moment where we can have this conversation. You know, I've told my own story so many times, but I don't know if I've ever really told my own story. You've heard the version of it about how my dad in Arusha, Tanzania, saw a picture of the Toronto City Hall and said, one day I'm going to go see that City Hall. And 30 years later, after a lot of struggle, a lot of sacrifice, but a lot of seva, a lot of service, he got to sit in a city hall thousands of kilometers away just before he died and saw his son become the mayor. And I've said many times that that may sound like an extraordinary story, but it's ordinary. It's ordinary because it is the story of this place. But it's not the story for all of us. And as much as I feel like I've led a life of anti-racism work, as much as I feel like I've led a life of fighting for human rights every single day, you don't always see that side. I don't often talk about the fact that when I was growing up, sometimes we were just a little bit poor. Most of the time, we were very poor. I don't often talk about the racism. I don't often talk about the fact that, well, I've been lucky enough not to have any interactions with the Calgary Police Service. I've been on the ground with a knee in my back and a gun at the back of my head by a police officer who said, you match the description of the suspect. And I often use my perfect Canadian accent and my big words and my outstanding public education to try and make change. And a lot of that covers up that anger.
a lot of that covers up that exhaustion that we feel every day. You know, 3 days ago, I started trying to set the framework for the work that we've done by laying out three provocative questions. And it was funny because some of the people that over the course of the day said, why is he asking those questions? Doesn't he know the answer? And I should have been a little more clear that I have an answer, but I was trying to be provocative. And the three questions were, can we hold in our hearts and our minds the two contradictory ideas of the fact that we are the greatest experiment in pluralism in the history of the world, and the fact that for many of us, that life of racism still exists? The second question was, what is systemic racism? I didn't ask that because I don't know. I asked that because I wanted everyone listening to ask themselves that and say, what are the systems that make a difference in my life? What are the systems that impact the way that I work and move and hopefully prosper through this community? Whether I'm white, whether I'm mainstream, whether I'm a member of a racialized community, whether I'm a Black Canadian or an Indigenous Canadian, because of course, nothing I've ever gone through compares to anything that Black Canadians and Indigenous Canadians and racialized women have had to go through. And the third question was, whose work is this? On Tuesday morning, just before this hearing, and I said this on Tuesday, but I'm going to say it again. On Tuesday morning, just before this hearing, I was doing a radio interview because I have that kind of privilege. I can set the stage. I get a microphone. And the question I was asked by a very thoughtful interviewer who genuinely wanted to know the answer was, well, you're a Muslim, not a person of color, a Muslim. For me, it's more about my faith than it is about the color of my skin. You're a Muslim. You've been the mayor for 10 years. Why haven't you solved systemic racism yet? And I didn't give him the answer I wanted to give him that morning. I didn't want to go there because he was well-meaning. And I wanted to answer the question in a way people could hear before we started these hearings. What I wanted to say was, no, of course I haven't solved it. And yes, I have failed. I have failed in so many ways. But why is it my job? Why is it only my job? Why is it that in the worlds in which I live, where almost every single day I am the only non-white person in the room, why do I carry that additional weight? And I recognize that I say that from a place of extraordinary privilege. So think about the extra weight that everyone else carries. Think about the exhaustion of that. Think about how in moving through your life, you got to be so much more. You can't just be an outstanding person in your profession. You've also got to be an ambassador for your race. Think about how that must feel. Now, don't just think about it. You heard it. Listen to what the people were saying about what that really means and what kind of a society we built. But despite that, despite being heartbroken, despite being exhausted, despite being really angry, I still come to that place of gratitude. I still come to that place where we can do it. We can do it here. There is nowhere in the world I would rather be than right here, right now. There is nowhere in the world I would rather be than having heard the testimony of these citizens these last 3 days. There's nowhere in the world that I'd rather be than in a place where we can have the tough conversations, in a place where my colleagues on City Council get it. They understand what we need to do right now. And so I don't think it's going to be ugly. It could be ugly. We can make it ugly. But I also think that we can be in a place of extraordinary creation, a place of incredible optimism for what is possible today. For the last 2 years, because yes, Councillor Craw, it is getting worse. And for the last 2 years, I've been saying the same thing over and over and over again. That there are people in our community that deride this work. There are people in our community who aim for division and anger and mean-spiritedness and hatred. Sometimes they call us snowflakes. And I always laugh when I hear that, because I think to myself, you know, being the mayor, I get to help run the snow removal budget. And one thing I know is that enough snowflakes put together are the most powerful force in the world. Bring on the blizzard, I say. But I also say that anger and mean-spirited and division and cannot win. We cannot allow them to win. That ultimately compassion and kindness and mercy and love must win. And these are not weak statements. These are not soft statements. These are statements of extraordinary power and extraordinary strength. Many of you will know the quote that I'm about to give you. Returning hate for hate multiplies hate, adding deeper darkness to a night already devoid of stars. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. It's Martin Luther King. And as we go through these mixed emotions, I still sit here in gratitude, and I sit here in love.
Thank you for dropping a speech on us, Mayor Nenshi.
I really wasn't going to.
Yeah, no one thought so, but that was great. Councillor Chahal to close. Yes, I did, didn't I? You heard that, Madam Clerk, did you not? Good.
First of all, I was honored to move these recommendations on Tuesday. Over the last 3 days, we have spent an enormous amount of time, and we probably need to spend still a lot more on listening and learning from over 150 speakers. They've had the opportunity to share their concerns, frustrations, and lived experiences in reference to systemic racism with people of color, and particular those in the Black and Indigenous communities. I, like Councillor Woolley, scribbling away here and at home of pages and pages of notes, and I was just so proud of all the people who had the courage to come up and tell their stories. I thought on a number of occasions that, you know, I want to be up there and tell a few, but I'll have my time. And it's important that we give those members of our community the space to do so. First of all, I want to thank all the speakers who attended, our distinguished expert panelists, Niall, who's still here. Thank you. A great conversation with lunch with you the other day as well, who presented to start this journey of learning, and as well as our co-chairs for the great job, Councillor Carraw, thank you, and Dr. Smith, thank you. As a member of council, I want to ensure that the speakers and the public at large that we are listening, learning, and committed to take action. For too long, elected officials and bureaucrats at all levels of government have paid lip service to this issue. Promises are made, a report is written, and some symbolic gestures are provided. I would say to all of you, and it was mentioned today, but I heard this the other day as well, and I'm paraphrasing, I do not accept breadcrumbs. Ask for the full meal on the big plate. That was Natasha Cloud from the Washington Mystics, a WBNA player. Your voices will lead to change if you remain committed to being vocal and continuously demanding change until change occurs. As a person of color, I will say this. Change is a collaborative effort. It's not about us versus them, or about finger pointing. We all have biases, including myself. We need to recognize, acknowledge, and come together to find solutions. Our Indigenous communities have been systemically brutalized, and yet we refuse as a society to address the underlying issues. I was born and raised in Calgary, and I acknowledge that throughout Canada, and particularly in the West, we have ridiculed, dismissed, and stereotyped the Indigenous population and have never accepted them as equal participants in society. We've blamed them. We blame their leaders without acknowledging the historical burden of responsibility. I also realize that we have never truly been taught about our rich cultural history. We were raised on a whitewashed version of history. Our rich history with settlers from all over the world, from Russia to Ukrainians, to Italians, to Vietnamese, to Indians, to Africans, to name a few. In particular, we have a rich Black history. I was never taught about the Black Americans immigrating to Alberta to escape from racism of the United States, establishing the community of Amber Valley, Alberta. Nor was I taught about John Ware, a Black cowboy who popularized steer wrestling here in Alberta. Watching Westerns growing up, it was never apparent up to 25% of the cowboys were Black in the late 19th century. I think for the first time I saw a Black cowboy, it was in the movie Blazing Saddles. I do not favor rewriting history. We can always find fault in our leaders of the past. We do not have a history of slavery or Jim Crow laws. We do have a history of racism. Racism and bigotry of the past is rooted in color of one's skin or historical attitudes in being anti-Catholic or anti-French or anti-Semitic. The prime ministers on our $5, $10, and $50 bills were all racists in hindsight. Thousands of Jews perished in the Holocaust as we refused them entry into Canada due to our anti-Semitism. Winston Churchill was considered a racist by his own peers. Mahatma Gandhi had racist views. What we can do is provide a better historical perspective, provide historical context, and not just glorify our historical figures. They were products of their time. We need to teach ourselves and the next generation of leaders in order to make progress and address systemic racism. On a final note to conclude, as I'm chairing the Community-Based Public Safety Task Force, I will note we are looking at the issue of systemic racism and discrimination and look forward to the engagement and presentations from all diverse groups in our city. I am appreciative that we have a cross-section of folks on our task force, which includes the police, and look forward to working with all task force members and bringing forward new ideas, initiatives, and change to the current system. Finally, I want to acknowledge what my colleague, Councillor Carras, said. Listening and learning is one thing. Pivoting to action is really what's critical here. Closed.
We'll do that after. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
On the main motion as amended, Councillor Farrell.
Yes.
Councillor Gondek.
Yes.
Councillor Jones. Councillor Keating.
Yes.
Councillor Magliocca.
Yes.
Councillor Sutherland.
Yes.
Councillor Woolley.
Yes.
Councillor Shahal.
Yes.
Councillor Chu.
Yes.
Councillor Colley-Urquhart.
Yes.
Councillor Davidson.
Yes.
Councillor DeMong.
Yes.
Councillor Farkas. Mayor Nenshi.
Yes.
Councillor Kara.
Yes.
That is carried unanimously. Thank you.
Awesome. Before I hand it over to our citizen experts who have been with us as members of the community from the start, I'm just going to hand it to Mayor Nenshi to address a small matter, but an important matter.
Thanks so much, Mr. Chair. I honestly, when I stood up, did not know what I was going to say, and I had one thing written down that I had to say, which I did not say, and I think it's important to raise it now, which is, as Councillor Gondek has so rightly pointed out, that statement that came from the police today was truly historic. It came from the rank and file police, it came from their union, it came from the senior officers, and it came from our citizen commission. Because remember, we do have citizen oversight of the Calgary Police Service here. And that didn't just happen. It happened because of a lot of leadership of a lot of people. But in particular, I really did want to thank the volunteers on the Calgary Police Commission. It is actually a remarkably diverse group of citizens, majority women, a number of people of color, Indigenous person, first Indigenous police commissioner in Canada, I think, Marilyn North Pagan, on that commission, led by a really extraordinary chair, Benita Croft. And in her, she's only been there for less than a year and has had a lot of this stuff land on her. And I know that that meeting today, you know, it happened during the hearing, which was unfortunate, but it was previously scheduled. But that meeting today was an important and, yes, historic meeting of the organization led by Chair Croft. And, you know, these are all volunteers, these citizens. Not everyone can take 3 days off and listen, and I'm grateful for those who have been able to do so. But I just did want to give my gratitude to Chair Croft, to the commission, for the work they're doing. On this one, Councillor Gondek, it is going to get ugly, probably going forward. But it's going to be an important discomfort for all of us. And we are well served by the folks we have sitting around that table as volunteers in the work they're doing. And that is another thing for which I am very grateful.
Thank you, Your Worship. I would like to tap the amazing Niall Barrow, who has been with us all through this. He was part of the expert panel. He's a criminal defense lawyer. And I can't thank you enough. Everyone said that they've had the chance to spend time with you, and just I have too, and really appreciate your being here. And I'd love your insights from this sort of insider-outsider position you find yourself in around this horseshoe.
Thank you. I've it's been an engaging process, a meaningful process, and I'm really happy to be here. I want to acknowledge, symbolically as it may be for me, but we remain on Treaty 7 land right now. Acknowledge that it's interesting to me that we always have been, but we get this amazing, like, I'm not used to being in this forum, on this kind of platform. So I'm kind of taken aback by so much. I'm hearing community members, some old friends, some people that I've never met that share stories of violence, just like me, things I've known people to have experienced. And yet I'm also here in my own comfort of privilege or position of intrigue. I'm sitting next to the mayor on the day of the city of Calgary, where I was born and raised, acknowledges that there's clearly systemic racism pervasive throughout this community. And it's acknowledged with the Calgary Police Service. And I suppose, like, if I step back, I should say, well, that's great. We're on the path to correction. And I mean, why wouldn't you be excited when the leadership of a world-class city and all its faculties is acknowledging something that we know is clear. But I'm hearing also that we're acknowledging it after these 3 days, and this is stuff that's been going on. And these people have been talking before these 3 days. They've been talking about the same stuff. And I'm talking about violence perpetrated by police towards individuals that have never ever been arrested or charged. So it's not just the criminals. And when we talk about systemic racism, we know that it impacts, of course there's criminals and there's minority criminals and that do heinous things and the police have to apprehend them. But it doesn't always need to involve violence and threats of violence. So that's the accountability that I would love to see, so that this meaningful change, as slow as it might take in the hiring processes and stuff, at the very least, the sanctity of the bodies of Indigenous and Black people can be safe. That's not too much to ask. It's what's right. We don't want that tomorrow. We wanted that for our entire history of our ancestors and going forward for the rest of our lives and the rest of our children's children's lives. Come on. We're talking about guns and physical violence, and the accountability has not been there. It has not been there, and I really hope it's going to be there. But it's interesting to see the bureaucracy take place as soon as the forum closes to the public and hear this debate start up about who's going to be involved in recognizing it. If you really want to be honest, it does not matter. If you're going to allow people with power to have 80% of the municipal budget and not request that they don't infiltrate violence on 30-40% of the population. Of course, 40% of the councillors here are minorities. Well then, why are 40% of the people that are in custody, remanded in jails, minorities as well? We need to start looking at this for what it is. If they're going to have 80% of the budget, they should have 100% of the accountability placed upon them. That's not too much to ask. We can all change our hearts. They should hear these types of stories and change. We can all change. I want us to change. I want to be a better part. I was born at the General Hospital. Okay? That doesn't exist anymore. It's in Bridgeland. They imploded it. It was a controlled demolition. They didn't say doctors and nurses and kids and maternity wards are bad. They imploded a hospital, and some would argue our healthcare system is still strong. So we can do things. I encourage council to do things with important institutions like policing. I'm going to focus on policing, but it comes with the hiring processes that affect all of those decisions. You can alter things and reallocate and hold people accountable without saying, oh, there's no racism or the violence isn't real. Just how about body cameras, accountability, transparency, and we just start moving on, get rid of the bad apples. It's pretty straightforward. Let people live in peace so they can, you know, get jobs without criminal records that they don't deserve. I think that's a good start. And then we can reward this amazing work that so many Calgarians want to be a part of. The great Calgarians that stand by quiet because it doesn't affect them. They exist and they're good Calgarians. But can we have accountability? I really would love to see accountability, you know? It's straightforward. If anybody's children were treated like that from anyone on the street, if a band of Black men walked down the street and assaulted someone, there would be issues to pay. That's it. And I'm so glad I'm sitting here with a diverse council. And, you know, it's a special moment for me, but that's kind of a weird place to just pretend everything's okay. It's really not. It's not okay. But I'm really overwhelmed to sit here and be around such great people and hear great people and know that even people that remain unconvinced can have their minds changed. I have that ability somehow. With the gift of some gab and some experience, I can actually change some people's minds. So I'm gonna try. And I'm so glad to be a part of this process. I don't know if I'll ever get this moment again. So I appreciate it. And I hope my community appreciates what I've done here. I've tried my best to just be myself and hold my position in my chair admirably. And I guess, you know what? Not everyone sees it. I don't speak for all Black people. I will be called token from some, I'm sure. Here I am. Thank you so much. I'm proud Calgary and I'm proud Canadian. It doesn't mean I'm ready to stop demanding rights and wanting to feel safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Niall. And now, to give us a master class on the master class we just experienced, Dr. Malinda Smith.
my co-chair.
Good evening, everyone. And thanks. It's been a privilege and an honor to sit here for 3 days and experience the gift of storytelling by so many Calgarians. And I know it will take me some time to reflect upon everything that this experience has meant, but to me it's come with a weight of responsibility, because that those stories were a gift to us, and we were entrusted with them, precious stories, painful stories, traumatic stories. And so this is not a moment for bureaucratic exercises. It's a moment for us to hold those stories close and realize and think about what our responsibilities are and how we are going to be accountable to each and every one of those persons that came forward. The great African-American Maya Angelou said, "History, despite its wretching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again." In my opening remarks, I told a little bit the story of Violet King Henry. And I asked some people, if they knew who she was. Many didn't. Violet King Henry was born in Calgary in 1929 to a family of Alberta's black pioneers. She attended Crescent High School, where she was the president of the Girls Association in grade 12. On her school yearbook, someone wrote, "Violet wants to be a criminal lawyer." She obtained a BA in 1952 and an LLB in 1953, becoming the first black Albertan to graduate from law school. She served in the Calgary law firm of Edward J. McCormick. She was called to the bar on the 2nd of June, 1954, becoming the first black woman in Canadian history to be called to the bar and become a lawyer. Violet King said, "People told me it wasn't a good idea for a girl to be a lawyer, particularly a colored girl. So I went ahead and did it anyway." In a speech to the Beta Sigma Phi sorority in Calgary in 1956, King voiced a prevailing recognition among black and racialized people: "You have to be twice as good to get half as far," when she lamented, 1956, "It is too bad that a Japanese, Chinese, or colored girl has to outshine others just to secure a position." That's 64 years ago. And over the past 3 days, it was like yesterday, we hear brilliant voices of black, indigenous, and racialized people saying they're sick and tired of doing twice as much to get half as far. People are weighed down by racism. They are burdened by it. They're tired. We heard stories of unfreedom, of freedom denied, opportunities squashed, doors closed, concrete ceilings. We heard harrowing stories, but we also heard poetry. We heard hope. We saw strength. Yeah, Calgarians showed up. But they also told stories that reminded us that justice is not blind. It's not colorblind. That experiences in Calgary are not race neutral. There's no equal or equitable opportunity. We must sit with that discomfort. That in every space we go into in the city, it is marked by racial injustice. That's not an individual experience or interpersonal only. It's systemic. So, in effect, we have human rights codes that say we don't discriminate on the basis of race, color, ethnicity, national origin, religion. These are non-performative. Those codes are on the book. The practice, the everyday experiences say something very different. We try to change, we try to tell different stories, we try to cover this up with euphemisms, racially tinged. We do all kinds of race evasions. People are tired of this. They're tired of the normalization of racism. They're tired that it's taken for granted such that we joke about it. They're tired of children being socialized into racism, growing up to be adults who are thought of as talented, brilliant people. But yes, they also engage in racism. It's the same people. Talented, brilliant people in all sectors of life. And that shouldn't be surprising to you, because there's in every tyranny, the tyrant could be also a lover of beautiful music. The tyrant could be a poet. So that's the contradiction. Also the contradiction that Mayor Nenshi talked about one of the greatest experiments in human history and pluralism, also one where systemic racism exists. They exist at the same time. And we cannot let the one obscure the other. I also want to say something, that racism is based not just on negative experiences of or overt hatred. It's also based on a preference for sameness. People are socialized into a preference for sameness, which is why you see the contradictions. I often tell people, you just because you're a woman doesn't mean you don't discriminate against women, because you're socializing to seeing white men as leaders. Women have that same kind of gender bias. And so the same person who says to you and me consciously, I'm woke, I am non-racist, I'm colorblind, is the same person in a moment, they're clutching their purses when they see a black person, they won't get on the elevator, they don't want to sit by a person of color on the bus. They're looking behind them, or they're shadowing them in the store. And yet that same person can imagine themselves as liberal, progressive, just. So we are living with these contradictions. And when those contradictions are exposed, people get defensive, reactionary, and we see the whole manifestation of white privilege and tears, which derail anti-racism conversations. We've heard discussions of overt racism, but also covert and more subtle forms of racism. But at the heart of all of what we are concerned about is systemic racism, how opportunities and outcomes for Indigenous peoples, year after year, decade after decade, centuries, for Black people, for Asians, Middle Easterns, Arab, Filipino, West Asians, Chinese, racialized minorities across various backgrounds, First Nations, Métis, of various nations, the experience that it's that, not just the individual experience, it is the collective sense that across all of those diversities, there is one thing that's in common. They experience the racial pecking order. They experience the sense of being outside the normative order. They experience this disproportionately. And that's when people say, what is systemic racism? That is what we mean by the masterclass in systemic racism. Because you can't say, oh, that's the odd case here. That's a random act there. It is pervasive. It permeates every institution. So I also started with the comment by Gary Young in 2019. When Young said, racism is not a metaphor. It's not a symbol for incompetence. It's not boorishness, impoliteness, or stupidity. Nor is it a state of mind. We think racism is an attitude, a deficiency in the social heart, intellect, emotional spirit. Racism is a system of discrimination. It's centuries old. And Indigenous people who spoke talk about 400 years. We talked about 200 years of slavery. All of these whitewashed out of our experiences. Racism denies people opportunities in housing, education, equality, human rights, safety, opportunity. It kills. People wore racism in their body. We felt the trauma. We felt the pain. Imagine every day of your life feeling that pain. We had to sit through it for 3 days. That is their life. That is not fair. It's not just. Racism is systemic. I'm glad we're coming to it. But I want to also then shift to saying, when I say systemic, let's think about it. From the cradle to the grave, from schools, teachers, principals, the bullying that they talked about, the harassment, denying BIPOC children their childhood joys, that freedom. Imagine how a parent having to tell their child, here's how you have to deal with the police. Imagine that conversation in grade school. Racism is a social determinant of health. Not race, racism. It impacts your health, physical, psychological, mental. The pain, the trauma. And then there aren't counselors who are trained to actually help you with this. Racism, it's the criminal justice system. Who gets the benefit of the doubt? Think about the woman who testifies who says, I knew how to persuade the police, you know, not to give me a ticket. I've seen it in action. But think about it too. Policing permeates every aspect of the life cycle of racial minorities and Indigenous peoples, from childhood to the grave. That's not what policing was about. Not when I studied policing. We talk about community policing, safety officers, peace officers, all that language. How is it possible that what we are talking about has come to this? Employment opportunities, whether it's public or private sector, unequal treatment, underemployment, underpaid. We know the stories of the overqualified. We talk to the engineers driving cabs. We talk to the cleaning people. I teach at a university. Often, sometimes the only black women I saw were when they came in at 4:30 to clean. And I made sure I stopped because that's sometimes the only other black female adult I could sometimes see in a week. For the longest time of my career, I was the only black woman political scientist in Canada. Now there are 6 of us. That's an Alberta story also. The creative arts and creative industries, we heard about racism. The media, entertainment, the malls, the bars, the restaurants. There were no safe spaces if you're racialized. Think about that. No safe spaces. What we are talking about is not interpersonal racism. We're talking about wasted brilliance, genius denied, creativity squashed. But we also heard stories about accessibility. Yes, accessibility in terms of disability. And isn't it remarkable how many people, the brilliance, who were talking about intersectionality, who were talking about Indigenous, racialized minority relations, they were who were attentive to visual disabilities, deaf culture, and the need to have access to the diverse signing, interpretation. Access is also about income. Who could sit here for 3 days or stay on the line for 3 days? And that's also about the precarity, what people had to give up. Think about that. What people had to give up in order for their stories to be heard and registered. Who could afford to take the time Despite that, people showed up. Yes, they talk about representation, but you will also notice people are fatigued by the diversity and inclusion, what some call it the diversity and inclusion racket. Because they know that diversity and inclusion has delivered nothing. They feel like they're being managed, they're being contained, but that the main beneficiaries are not the people, not racialized people. And you talk about the city council having four racialized people, but almost every other institution is marked by whiteness. That's the other side of this story that we haven't attended to, the preference for whiteness in every institution in Canada. So when we say a seat at the table, people do not want just a presence at the table. They do not want the breadcrumbs from the master's table. The master's tool will not dismantle the master's house, what the Lord said. They want voice, they want power, they want equitable access because they are qualified, they have worked hard, and they have ambition, and they have the desire. It is the walls they face day in and day out, the barriers, the obstacles that are so self-repeating that from I told the story of Violet King to this moment, people don't even know who she is. But the stories of the policing, I have to come back to this. So yes, representation in all institutions, but not tokens, not breadcrumbs. People want equitable, meaningful access. Profiling, I'm sorry, that's the Canadian apology, is racist. Because you cannot have the diversity, the Statistics Canada came out with a study about the diversity of the black population in Canada, over 124 different countries, multilingual, multi-religious. You cannot, that is, the reason why a former chief of staff for the mayor could be stopped, the reason why the lieutenant governor of Nova Scotia, African Nova Scotian, can be shadowed in a shopping. The reason why I can be shadowed and every time I go in the shop, or people don't want to sit beside me when they're on the bus. It's not about education. It's not about my class. I mean, some of these people could be in my class. What it is about is what Desmond Cole called the skin we are in. This is racism. You are stopped, if you're stopping people because of the color of their skin, it is racism. I'm sorry. And it's against the human rights codes. It violates a basic human rights principle from the first human rights codes, first bills of rights, racism, judging a person on the basis of their skin. It disproportionately impacts black people and indigenous peoples and brown peoples. So driving while black, flying while Muslim is a thing. Trying to get service in a restaurant while indigenous, trying to get housing. These are basic necessities of life are denied. That's systemic racism. So let me conclude. So I want to make my point with this. Black people, indigenous people, think about it. Working hard, and just by the color of your skin or what you look like, you are deemed suspicious, you're deemed dangerous, you're deemed out of place, you're deemed as not belonging. What does that say about what the police understand as who belongs? Public spaces are for white people, is what profiling tells us, what carding tells us. Because you will be stopped otherwise. And I'm not speaking about just the stories told here, I'm telling you my own story too, because we all know this story. It's not tenable, it must stop. So I want to thank from the bottom of my heart each and every person who showed up with all of their brilliance, their courage, who fought through the hurt, the pain, to tell their story, but disrupted the idea of a single, simple story based on a stereotype. They showed up, and their collective story, yes, it was a masterclass in systemic racism, but it was also one in courage. It was one in courage. One word that is interwoven throughout the 3 days, and I've heard said here again tonight, is, and they want accountability. People want institutions to be accountable for the deep structural inequities they deal with. We public servants act for the public good, and the public good cannot be color-coded. Their testimonies cannot be in vain. We cannot fail them. Their traumas could not have been reanimated in vain. We are accountable for them coming forward and telling their stories. We cannot let them down. So again, Maya Angelou, courage is the most important of all virtues, because without courage, you cannot practice any other virtue consistently. You can practice any virtue erratically, but nothing consistently without courage. Do not squander the gift you have been given. This is your moment. This is your time. You will be judged by what you do going forward. Not by what's written on a document, not by a speech, but by the difference you make in the everyday lived experiences of Black, Indigenous, racialized peoples in the city. The gift you were given, we were given with those stories, is an opportunity to change the narrative about Calgary going forward. We heard the overwhelming sense of fatigue, the exhaustion, the unbearable weight of whiteness. People are exhausted by the tyranny of deficit stories about Black and Indigenous peoples. They're tired of the tyranny of low expectations. You can't do this in a can-do city, in a can-do province. They don't want to be the, we can't do this. They want to be able to create, be creative artists. They want to be able to lead corporations. They want to be entrepreneurs. They want to make a difference. They want Calgary to be better, and they want to be part of the solution. That's a dream. That's a gift. The testimonies invite us to attend to, in the poetics of Isabel Allende, the stories and experiences that get lost in the fog of repetitive absence. The fog of repetitive absence, the absence of visible minorities in most of the spaces we probably experience in the city, in institutions. And the negative assumptions and biases that function to circumscribe the futures of racialized minorities and Indigenous peoples. Those who entrusted their stories to us also invited us to write a new script for Calgary. As the Nigerian novelist Ben Okri reminded us, we should be careful of the stories we tell. He reminds us of the potentially transformative power of stories telling. And so Calgarians came forward with all their genius, and they gave us the materials to write a new narrative about Calgary, to make the words of inclusion on the paper a reality. So Okri says, if we change the stories we live by, quite possibly we can change our lives. The stories you and I have heard here today were a gift to help us change the lives of these Calgarians. Thank you.
Thank you. So everyone will recall that 3 days ago, we started things in a good way with the Sitka elders, Kelly and Daphne Good Eagle, doing a smudge ceremony. It was their intention to come back yesterday night when we concluded. It was their intention to try and be here today at some random point when we might conclude the proceedings. And in the difficulty of scheduling them, a beautiful idea was born. And the idea was, and the commitment to everybody, is that this is not concluded, or at least this part of the work is not concluded until council ratifies this on the 20th. And so it is the idea that Kelly and Daphne Goodeagle will come and close the proceedings when we vote the refined recommendations on the 20th. And so that's what we're going to do to end things in a good way. And so I'm not actually adjourning, although procedurally I'm adjourning. From the perspective of the work we're doing here, it is merely recessed. But with regard to this committee, I'm adjourning. Thank you, everyone. Roll call to adjourn them.
Well, okay. Thank you.
So moved.
Councillor Gondek.
Yes.
Councillor Jones. Councillor Keating.
Yes.
Councillor Maglioka.
Yes.
Councillor Sutherland.
Yes.
Councillor Woolley.
Yes.
Councillor Kara.
Yes.
Councillor Shahal.
Yes.
Councillor Chu.
Yes.
Councillor Kaliarkart.
Here.
Councillor Davison.
Yes.
Councillor DeMong.
Yes.
Councillor Farkas. Councillor Farrell.
Yes.
Mayor Nenshi. Yes. That's carried.